Hi, guys. This is Jean Holden, producer of the show. And I just wanted to take a minute to let you know where you can find us on the internet. Please go to ThatMan on fatman.com. There you can find out all the things you need to know about the show. You'll be able to find links to the podcast, to YouTube, to Twitter, Facebook, even Instagram and Snapchat. Thank you so much for listening, guys, and we hope you enjoy the show.
Today's show is brought to you by Death Wish Coffee. Death Wish Coffee, the strongest coffee in the world.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman, and I want to urge you to make a generous donation to the Wayne Foundation so we can stop the sexual trafficking of children. Do it, or I'll find you.
And don't forget to check out our good friend of the show, Mark Live, over at chundertunes.com for all your podcast animation needs.
ThatMan on Fatman is recorded with a Zoom H6 handy recorder.
Zoom.
For creators.
Disclaimer. The show you're about to experience is for entertainment purposes only. The hosts use mature language and conversation just like in most of life. If you're too uptight, this might not be for you. All that said, we really do hope you enjoy the show. But if you don't enjoy it, expect a nice big shipment of my joyous Joker juice on your doorstep in the very near future. Toodles!
As the world's biggest Kevin Smith fan, I appreciate the fact that somebody finally made a podcast about that interesting motherfucker. So, yes, you absolutely did the right thing. It was smart. I appreciate it. I think you were right to do that.
Okay. What has two thumbs and is a huge fan of Kevin Smith? That man!
Yes, I am that man.
The juggernaut of a podcast.
We need a costumed vigilante is what we need. Justice can't be served unless it's being fought outside the system.
Here's what we're going to do, eh?
Oh, shit. It's that man. Who is he? He's that man. He's talking. Go get him, that man.
Well, once upon a time, a regular man read a book written by the Fat Man. Tough shit, written by old Kev Smith. Kev said go out and start a podcast, and so I did, and I had a real blast. But my obsession was driving my co-host nuts. Didn't want to bring the podcast down. Needed Porkchop Murphy to hang around. So I create a new show with one heck of a plan, and I call that show That Man on Fat Man, because we're going to chat about Kevin Smith. That's right, let's talk about old Kev Smith.
Yes, please note that use of all sound effects is done ironically.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to this. Wow, I got a reverb and everything. Wow, hey, ZM Radio, everybody. Nice to see you out there. Welcome to Z-Morning Zoo, CBS FM. All right. Sorry about that, folks. I had reverb on. I didn't realize it. It's Scott Holden, That Man on Fat Man, episode 4-8, I think. Yes, we're one short of 409. So, and it's going to be kind of a crazy show. We're going to take it off the hook a little bit today, but as usual, sitting in the studio with me today is none other than producer extraordinaire. And part-time co-host, Gene Holden.
Part-time. I love that part-time.
That was a new one. I don't even know where that came from. Wow, like we got a peanut gallery, too. We should have this every week.
Yeah. The part-time stuff is kind of nice.
Okay, yes. And now, usually we have a guest segment, but since we're doing something a little different this week, I'm going to introduce none other then Pete and Nick from the podcast. Please say the name because I can't remember right now because it went out of my head because I need it.
Go for it, Nick.
Where are my seats?
That's right.
Where are my seats podcast?
That's the old podcasting nerves. Like as soon as you need something.
Yes.
It pulls right out. Let me give you guys a little more juice.
Just a bit.
By the way, sorry before Gene.
Like Bane.
We're laughing.
Feed the.
We heard your voice in the early promo there. And it's like, her mouth is not moving. Oh. It's like telekinesis. Oh, not telekinesis, telepathy.
Yes. Yes, we played the intro. We recorded the old-fashioned way.
You know what I love is that I'm blocked by the Samsung monitor, so yeah. I can't see Scott, but I like it because I'm using my imagination listening to Scott, and I feed off of that, so it's great.
What
so
is the face Scott is making now?
You know, don't make any...
What face is he making now? It's a game.
Yeah, right. It's like we're doing like
how
a crescent
thing
he here. Hey, Scott, start holding up like a triangle, a circle, a wavy line.
Well, the truth of the matter is, in general... Oh, you know what I've realized? Like an idiot. See, I've got to do too many things. I'm like 500 camera angles behind. So here's me, everybody, Scott Holden.
Hey.
Here's Gene, everybody.
Hey.
And now, of course, here's the two of us, but then here's our guests.
Hey!
Oh, it's there. Where is it? Oh, here we go.
There.
There's a little shadow.
I was waving at
parts of the room.
I was waving at the lamp.
And now here's
everybody.
Listen,
I just came back from Amsterdam, so I have a reason for waving at the lamp. That's space cake.
So now we're all on camera, too, so that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. Hey, I'm representing Deathwish, I just realized.
Yeah. Very nice.
Look at me. Everyone look at me. So the concept for today is, instead of doing a normal show format, we're going to do the top 10 episodes, my top 10 episodes, my favorite Smodcast episodes.
Excellent.
This is my list, and so I'm accountable for it, so no one else is.
Now, does Gene know your top 10 prior to this?
They're all...
She pretty much has a good idea because she lives with me.
And does she agree with your top 10 list?
I think for the most part.
Yeah, they all intertwine. They're pretty much the same.
They're pretty much the same. That's good to you.
Cool.
Yeah.
So she will co-sign this bullshit.
Gotcha.
But tell before we get started on that, tell us a little about your podcast, where we can find it, and how you started.
Good, Nick. I call you the creator of.
I'm the creator.
You are.
And on the first day, no.
Do you guys know do you guys happen to know the That Man on Fat Man episode you're on?
408. You just
said. Yes.
Well, that's this one. No, I mean,
sorry,
the one, I mean the one.
You said
you're so witty.
He aces those.
The one beforehand, the one that you've already been on, because this is not. I know that you.
Well, hold on a second.
You've been
on
too.
Yeah,
but
I was in
the one with the Flophouse.
With Dan McCoy.
It's a great episode.
Which we made
it is,
top 10
it.
For last
great,
year.
Yes, great episode. I love that episode. I really do.
But we were. Let's see. I don't remember the number we were on.
I was hoping you did because I can't remember it either.
Okay.
Well, you're not looking up on me.
And I just realized, shit, I'm unprepared again. Another thing I'm not prepared for.
We're all unprepared.
Yeah.
There was a lot of MST3K talk. I remember that.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Very much so.
Yes.
It has returned.
Yes.
Yes. And it is back. And that's why not too long ago we. It's so weird. We were talking just a little bit before the show, as both being Mystery Science. I'm filling the audience in here. As both being Mystery Science Theater fans, Nick and I were talking, and we jumped right into critiquing episodes, but also to the shock that Elliot is like...
But he's leaving the East Coast.
See, now, I didn't know that they were thinking of... I didn't even realize they were thinking of replacing him, because in my conversation with him, with those guys, I was like... Clearly, you're going to be using Skype to have him on the show, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then on the next episode, they're like, here's someone we're auditioning.
Oh,
wow.
No.
Are you serious?
That was, what was it, Paul from Paul and Storm.
Yeah.
And actually, Paul and Storm were actually two of the guys that did some of the music for the series.
Yeah, I mean, I got...
MST3K. And, Elliot brought them on. Or him on, I should say. Paul of Paul and Storm. And he's East Coast guy.
You and I should just do an MST3K episode.
Yes.
We should just do an MST3K pod.
Hey,
I am a card-carrying member.
Wow. Oh, my God.
That gets you a discount at Sunoco or something?
If you do the work, I'll gladly... If you do the work, I would gladly... Seriously, if you do the work, I will gladly co-host. Because I would love to go...
That's a great idea.
I would love to do a show where I can just show up and be funny and not have any of the fucking... All of this to worry about.
Gotcha. Yeah.
But I would gladly do that. I would love. Okay. I mean,
that's
a no brainer for me because I qualify as well. I don't have my ID, Nor do I still have my Tom.
Mass your papers.
Nor do I still have a Tom Servo, but at one point.
Oh, I did see the picture. I did see the picture. And I used to have a Crow, which fell apart.
And at
as
one
well.
Point, I had fucking boxes and boxes of those goddamn videotapes.
The tapes. Actually, Pete was a tape trader. That's actually how I first started watching.
Oh, so you're correct. But
so you
listen,
qualify as well.
Well, I'm going to say I'm like the Will Wheaton of TNG. What was his name?
Wesley.
I'm the Wesley crusher, yeah, of knowledge on MST3K, whereas right here, it's all the way. He's the Picard number one as far as knowledge, you know what I mean?
I'm not even sure
Make
if it's
it so.
I'm not sure if it's still in the bathroom, but it may be. But in our bathroom reading was the Colossal episode guide.
Oh,
the
yes,
the original one that only went up to like seven. Yeah. And then you had to download the rest, or you could pull the rest off Sci-Fi, which I did, and bound.
Mm-hmm.
Spiral bound. With laminated cover.
That is
very cool.
The last, because I had access to office supplies.
Awesome.
I was a manager.
See, boys and girls, management will let you do that.
All right, son, I have a special project for you. You have to pick just the right person for that project. I need you to print out all of the episodes from the episode guide that was online on Sci-Fi.
Nice.
And then coil bind it and remember to laminate those covers. Thank you. Man, use cardstock if you can.
Those are all mic episodes.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
All right, so we'll have to do some MST3K.
Yes.
As you can tell, it's a passion here. I don't know how this came about, but it did. But anyway, we're trying to get those guys back because we interviewed them very early on in our filming process for our documentary. Mm. And yeah, so much has happened to Elliot. I mean, we have footage of them talking about how MST3K is, you know, there is an influence for them starting their podcast. Huh. Fucking full circle story. The dude is now the head writer.
Right.
How can we not get another interview from this guy before he finishes movie?
Oh, yes.
So that's what we've been working on. And that's when I found out he's leaving and possibly I was like, Skype?
I can't imagine.
Skype. Yeah, no, from what I understand, that's going to be Skype.
I wonder.
They're not placing him, although it's going to be weird knowing that he's not physically there.
With
some of the banter that they have sometimes going on, it is localized to, you know.
But they've had people sit in besides Elliot. So one of the women, what's her name?
Holly Hagelin.
Yeah.
She also from The Daily Show.
Right.
But you...
Steph.
You can't just cast... Elliot has a very
distinct
sound. I mean, like, and the three of them...
He is so funny, Elliot.
They've got three distinct voices. That was the toughest thing on MST3K right there to get past in those new episodes. I don't know why.
The voice of Tom Servo was the most
distinctly
that's what it
different.
Was for me
it's
too.
Almost...
And,
actually,
except Gypsy. Gypsy is totally different.
It reminds me of fucking Elvis, Josh Elvis Weinstein.
Oh, J. Elvis, for the first season.
It's more tonally like that. And here's my other problem with it. Like, his voice blends so much with, what's his name?
Crow?
No, the new guy. Josh.
Baron Vaughn.
Who's the guy in the middle? Who's the new host?
Oh, Jonah. Jonah
Hill.
Jonah and Tom Servo's voices are tonally so similar.
I do get that.
It's very hard to tell who's delivering what line at any given time.
Oh,
that's a good point.
Kevin Murphy had a very distinct
and
voice
as Servo. And was a fucking genius.
Yes.
Oh, hilarious. And also a great singer. Like, all those little ditties
all
that they used to do.
They all were, like, frustrated performers and shit. Yeah. Oh, my God. We got to get off the subject. We're supposed to talk about... Wait a minute. This is supposed to be top 10 Smodcast episodes.
It's the ADD hour.
Maybe I should fucking just change the episode. We could just call it the fucking MST3K Suckfest. God. All right. Well, let's at least try and do this countdown, because I promised the fucking audience.
Yeah.
I brought you in here. You guys are jack of all trades, geeks who sort of know a lot about stuff and definitely have opinions.
That's for sure.
All right, so to do the top 10 episodes. Oh, wait. Oh, we do have Smed lines, but it's very simple Smed lines. Do you want me to do the whole? We don't really want you to do the whole theme.
We'll just share about the Moose Jaws teaser poster is out.
Oh, yes. That just like literally came out moments ago or something.
And What were we talking about before?
What's your name? Lisa. Lisa.
Yeah. Lisa Spoonhour. Yeah. Yes, we're very sorry.
Yeah, our condolences go out to the friends and family of Lisa Spoonhour. Made, you know, most people know her from Clerks, where she played
Caitlin Bree.
Right. That's right. The first of the Bree sisters.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and notoriously fucked a dead guy.
in the bathroom.
Yes, in the bathroom.
And then went catatonic as a response.
Yeah. Right.
Yes. And if you follow the filmic lore, she is the older sister of Chasing Amy's. What's her first name? The main character.
Oh.
The one, Jolie Lauren Adams.
Yeah. Yes. Lauren Adams.
But I'm trying to remember her character name.
Yeah, why are both of us so why are all of us so stupid?
I know.
Yeah,
I can't.
We're Kevin Smith experts,
you're the one that came back
too.
From Amsterdam. Why can't I think?
Wasn't
that Samantha?
This is the
Is that Samantha, is it?
No, Samantha's the middle one. No, or is it? Because in Mallrats...
Mm-hmm.
All right. This is like
it's driving you crazy.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
We're gonna pause. Just watch all of Kev's movies. We'll be right back.
No, we know these things.
I know.
It's synapse error. It's the it's performance anxiety. It's exactly this is
error 404.
This is ADD in a nutshell. It's like I feel like it's like in my hopper. You know, it's like right there, and for some reason the release valve won't let it out. And then finally...
Okay, I looked
okay,
it.
So she was Alyssa Jones.
Alyssa Jones, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Who,
and Banky is my favorite in that.
If it's Alyssa Jones...
Banky is Jason Lee.
We're not worried about Banky.
Okay.
So now go to Mallrats.
Wait, Jason Lee is the guy that's been doing all that art all over the world? You know?
Now go to Mallrats.
Yeah.
Oh, no, okay. I'm sorry, that was Banksy. Yeah.
Oh, Banksy. Yeah.
What are we doing with Mallrats
There's
now?
Caitlin Bree.
Oh,
Mallrats. Okay.
What's her name? The girl who writes the book.
Oh, not what's her name? Not from 90210. The other one.
Who's actually dating Trevor?
Trish the Dish.
Trish the Dish. That's right.
There we go.
So Trisha Jones. Trisha Alicia.
Trisha Jones. Trish
Alicia. What about Trisha?
Trisha Jones.
Trisha.
That's her sister.
Yes. Then there's Alyssa.
Mm-hmm.
Oh no, I'm confusing him. Third girl is actually fucking Kevin's old girlfriend. Kim Lochran.
Okay.
She's in the scene with Ernie
in the
hot box, the sweat box scene where he's like, "Hey, I heard you grunt when you picked up that quart of milk, gallon of milk. You need a personal trainer." That's my worst ever.
Ernie would be proud.
Yes.
Yeah, Ernie's cringing.
We saw him recently too.
Yes, we did.
We met his wife.
Oh
we
my
finally
gosh.
Met his
oh, really?
Wife.
Yeah.
Yes, we're never gonna get to this top 10 count. Maybe I should just fucking change the episode.
Yeah.
Midway through, scratch the top 10. We'll
just
do that next show. Fuck this. Because you know what? We got plenty to fucking talk about.
You can create like 5 podcasts out of this.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Just chop it up.
And what sucks is I had these guys sit and wait while I cut out like 2 episodes. It took like 20 minutes in and of itself, 2 clips.
Yeah,
so.
We had a nice chat though, so it's fun.
Oh, yes.
But anyway, so we finally met Ernie's wife, and it was just like, it was weird the way we did it because Gene went up to her sort of unannounced and without me.
She was sitting with her husband. Ernie. She was sitting with Ernie, though, so it wasn't like I just went up.
Yeah. I understand.
Right.
Yeah. That's why she was like, "Who the fuck is this bitch?"
No, she wasn't like that. But I could say, the way I came up to her, I said, "Hi, I'm so happy to finally meet you." But it's weird when someone just says that. I didn't even introduce myself. It was very awkward. I don't know what I was thinking. But then I got to fix it later.
Cool.
And how was the fix?
I just talked about the fact that they went to the...
She grabbed him by the pussy.
Was Billy Bush there?
They like that, especially when you're famous, you know.
Yes, when you're famous, they let you.
But you can do that.
Of course.
They let you. You can get away with it.
By law, they have to.
It's in the Constitution.
Ernie took her to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That's
nice.
Yes.
Hey, we were
there.
No, not the Hall of Fame. He took her to the Hall of Fame concert.
The concert.
Oh, cool.
The induction.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember who was inducted this year.
Journey was
one. Okay.
And they had the fucking, you know, the guy from Thailand or whatever it was.
Arnell.
Oh, yes.
What's his name?
Arnell Pinada.
He is fucking amazing.
They hang him from a rope every once in a while and swat at him.
And you
Kenny
know,
comes out. You know.
As someone, you know,
that's
who's been in bands. Yeah, I know.
You seen it?
Yeah. As someone who's been in bands, I love that shit. Because Steve Perry was being a douchebag, and they're like, and he's like, you guys can't go out without me, and fuck you. And I want more money.
I'm irreplaceable.
I want more money if you do it. And they're like, and then they see this fucking guy on YouTube.
Oh my God, he's so good.
Who's like as good, if not better, than Perry
in
his prime.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And they're like, well, okay, well, we'll go out with this guy instead. And the fucking crowd didn't care.
No.
Mm-hmm. You know, they loved it. It was like, wow, he's awesome. He's better than Steve Perry.
Yeah. Steve Perry was smart not to, I think, sing at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction because there's no way he's able to hit those notes anymore.
And now, they were telling us that there was some very weird stuff going on there. Like, that was all very, because, you know, management was like, this one can't be with that one.
Yeah.
It was all, it was all that.
I didn't hear about that.
It was all that backstage shenanigans shit.
Well, it seems like
Perry
he came out with everyone, like, from backstage, and then the one backstage.
Yeah, and then they played without him.
Yeah.
Yes.
He didn't even sit with anybody or and then I think
that's
they
as bad
did
as the guy from Metallica, how they did him.
Oh my God. Was that the
it
Grammys?
Fuck Hetfield.
With Lady Gaga, you mean?
Or no. Something like maybe it was MTV's something like Achievement Award of the Year or like a Lifetime Achievement Award.
Right. But you're saying when his vocal was completely like
No, I'm saying when they'd fired Hetfield left the band and he went and did that other thing.
That was a while ago.
Then they just got it was all in fucking some kind of monster.
Oh, Mustaine. Is that you talking about?
Oh, Dave Mustaine.
When Dave Mustaine
the bass player.
Oh, Jason Newsted.
Jason Newsted.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Who did I say?
No, well,
you said Hetfield.
Hetfield.
I meant Newsted.
The Hetfields of the McCoys.
Yes.
And his bass tracks sound like crap on that Injustice for All album. Like
I tell you,
they're non-existent.
I love Some Kind of Monster.
Yeah,
it's like watching.
That's a great doc.
It's watching the best train wreck.
Yes,
it is like it is.
You can't look away.
It's like this is how a billion-dollar band comes apart.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
In every
right.
cliche, and I do hand it to them. Those guys were fucking. They let it out, you know what I mean? They said, fine, this is what it's like. And, of course, they managed to save the band, too, and all that
of
shit.
Of course,
yeah.
Or save the business, whichever you prefer.
Right.
And, come on, I also love the fact that Saint Anger has got to be the biggest piece of shit they ever put out.
Oh,
except for maybe Reloaded Part 7 or whatever.
Yeah. The trash can drum sound, you remember that, right?
One of my favorite parts in that movie is when fucking Lars plays plays this one cut to his father, who looks like the old man from fucking the inside of Led Zeppelin 4 album cover, you know, with the fucking with the lantern.
Yeah, right.
and he's like, if I were you, I would never play this to anyone again.
Sound advice.
It really was. It was shit, too. Yeah. But meanwhile, they had record agents telling them, oh, you should lead with this track. It's amazing, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Licking their ass.
Piss on vinyl. We need the money.
Lars, what's your feeling on digital music now?
You know what?
Napster.
Lars caught a lot of shit,
but
the truth of the matter is he had every right to fucking do that.
Understood, yeah.
Everybody,
you know,
and you know what's funny? If the movie business had been the first to get digitized, you think for a second anyone would have fucking, you think anyone would have tried to pirate that shit and not been sued top to bottom, upside down? Oh, it's movie sharing. You know what I mean? That was such, I mean, granted, it was a nice loophole in the age of technology, but it was stealing.
Oh,
every
much so.
Up and down, sideways. And as someone who is an artist, that's bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, I don't expect much, but if I put out a work and, you know, it's special and I want to get paid for that, I give away enough shit.
I read statistically that, you know, they since the introduction of Spotify and these other music streaming services, that the piracy, they said, is like, it's gone way down. Yeah.
Of course.
Which,
because you have
it
access.
Was a smart model.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, you
I just hope that the
now.
Artists are getting paid fairly through Spotify. I'm hearing that maybe not, you know.
See, yeah.
But I know it's a real tough,
all this
debatable topic.
All
right
this now. Stuff is tough.
Yeah.
If I'm a musician, I'm still recording, but I'm really practicing on live because live is where you're going to make your money.
That's exactly what I read.
It's also
touring,
where,
right?
Yeah, it's where you can't recreate that.
Mm.
You know, you can't.
Yeah, those moments.
I would fall in. I would try and niche myself into a jam band.
Yes.
Or a tribute band.
Right. Like a band like Pearl Jam, they will be able to tour forever. They're always going to have an audience. You two.
Pearl Jam?
I
like Pearl Jam.
Forget Pearl Jam. I'm just saying, like, I'm just giving them it as an example.
So Pearl Jam just chores on, like, one good album and then a lot of shit.
Right. Mm-hmm. But I'm saying they're bands that, no matter what, everyone's always going to go out to see them, regardless. There's an audience.
But they're a mega band. I'm talking about. See, we had a whole episode. We had a whole couple of episodes about music.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the one with Schiaffo.
We had a couple of Schiaffo was
right.
That was a great episode.
Yeah, Chris Penny's in that, and like a bunch of and it's just musicians.
Where you guys shared the track and added,
that was cool
and that was great.
Cool too. But to me, what was more interesting is like live should be. Where artists are making real, where they can make money that no one else can claim, where you don't have to worry about digital rights and shit.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But where do people play? Where are the venues anymore? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean,
it's true.
Even in the fucking city.
The rock venues have gone kind of fallen by the wayside. I've noticed that too.
I know that everything's shrinking. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, you can get a DJ in with 5 billion things and, you know, on a fucking iPod or whatever.
You know, I'll tell you something that, like, about...
But even DJs are starting to become showbiz. Like, they're turning their things into more of a stage presence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like, you know? DJ
Dead Mouse.
And last night we were at a party and the DJs were, you know, like, there's three DJs and they're doing all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's nuts. And it's a show.
Right.
So.
You know, I used to go to Boston like regularly, you know, 10, 15 years ago. Let's call it like during like the 90s. And you could throw a rock and hit a rock club. I mean, there was like one every, you know.
Was that how it was
named? By the way, what's the name of your band? Because we should reveal.
Oh, Wind Up Monkey, a local cover band, you know. But enough about that craziness right now.
hey, local cover band qualifies. Anyone there is like from fucking Metallica. So a local cover band, the band experience is a thing. And it doesn't matter if it's... The only thing about Metallica and your local band is they have much bigger problems. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. They have to worry about, like, the machine of touring and the machine of the... But besides, I mean, the band experience... Forming a band, learning how to play in a band, learning how to, you know, gig and do all that shit, learning how to fucking get an encore, learning, you know, all that stagecraft, which is part of music that no one thinks about until they start doing it.
Sure.
Like, oh my God, this is a performance that I'm doing here.
Until you're there.
Yeah, exactly. And those are like moments, but that whole experience is always the same. So when people piss on wedding bands or anything like that, anyone who's been in a band knows that's bullshit.
Yeah.
You get the same experience playing in front of 100 people as you do playing in front of 1,000, except for 1,000 might be better because it's more people.
Right. Yeah. Looks. I'll finish my point real quick, though, about I was back there a year ago to see friends of mine in a band called Expanding Man. They were signed to Sony and then they were on the Cable Guy soundtrack and like 100 other bands, you know, I'm sure like that, you know, they just fell by the wayside. And now the guy's doing real estate. You know, I mean, it just some of these bands panned out like Stone Temple Pilots. And then you had bands like Expanding Man that were just like, bye bye, you know, one record and done. But so they were telling me that I was talking to some of the local musicians. They said to me, like, all the rock clubs are gone now in Boston, that it's like there's maybe, he said, like, you know, a couple places to play,
dude,
whereas
CBGB's
before they used to be triple
is
that.
Gone.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
CBGB's, Lemoore's is gone.
Wetlands.
Oh,
right.
Lemoore's.
Wetlands was like the, you know, the mecca.
Yeah.
And why are they gone? Condos.
Yeah,
or,
right. Birch Hill, right? Another place that got replaced by condos.
The Gap.
Yeah.
Or fucking the limelight is literally a mall.
Yes, I know. I drive by it.
I came back, you know, after 10 years of being in Virginia.
Really,
I'm like walking down.
Song,
there's fucking the limelight, the rock and roll church, whatever the fuck. And I walk inside. I remember at the moment I snapped a picture and I put the caption, I saw fucking Guar in this mall. You know what I mean? This is
That's
fucked
fantastic.
Up.
Now I'm trying to picture Guar playing in a mall, kind of like the old Tiffany in the late 80s there.
It's so fucked up.
That is crazy, right? Yeah.
I think we're all
And I think right, CBGB's now is what? It's a...
I don't even know.
I read it and I wanted to cry. It was,
it was
a clothing store,
but
I think.
But it was simply a rent thing. That's the truth. It was simply a rent thing.
Yeah. That's exactly it. And that's what the owner of CBGB said.
How
that? Not the owner, the landlord. I'm sorry.
How long had CB's been there?
Wow, long time.
Because I wonder if they had qualified.
Because Blondie played back at CBGB's.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Blondie,
might they have
heads.
Tried to qualify as like a landmark or some shit?
Oh,
like,
a historical landmark.
Like the gay nightclub did in New York. Well, I can't think of the name of it right now. I should, but I can't think. But anyway.
The tunnel? I have no idea.
No. Oh. It was like a big, there was a big famous riot there, and it's sort of the beginning of gay activism.
Right.
It sort of marks the beginning of all that.
Okay.
And it was recently made a landmark in the city.
Oh, wow.
And so now it's protected. And
interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a civil landmark and a historic landmark because of that, because of what happened there.
But definitely, like CBGB's, a lot of those like famous ones. And
Is the Spiral still open? Is the Red Lion still open?
I don't think they are.
And then just like the local scene is just
like iconic.
Shot.
Yeah.
Like you're doing all the local
I think a lot
gigs.
Of shows moved to Brooklyn. That's my impression.
Like, with all the
I know
hipsters?
A couple musicians. No, I know some musicians, and that's when they get gigs, that's where they seem to be.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. Like,
well,
let it
start somewhere. I mean, this, you know.
It seems like everything moved to Brooklyn that was cool.
Yeah. Mm.
Oh, I hear that from my buddy who lives up in Harlem. He's like, Manhattan has become like a wasteland. Like, everybody's in bed by 1 a.m. now. You know, it's not like the olden days where,
okay.
You know,
you want to talk a flash from the past. Okay, so Gene and I met in 1990? Yeah, 1990.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Grunge.
Yeah, and
the crunch.
And July, of all things. July of 1990. We met in June, but
those were good
so
times.
Late in June that it became July. Oh, my God. We're sort of on an anniversary then.
Those were good times.
Congratulations.
They?
Think about that.
Yeah.
So that's how many years?
Fuck. Well, not, we
what
met,
year is it now?
I thought we met in 19.
So what is that, 27
okay, we met
years?
I think it's 27 years.
Yeah.
We've
27.
Been,
wow.
We've been dating.
Ago today. No,
dating to marriage, 27 years.
Yeah.
In,
like around now.
Let's bring in the cake.
Yay.
But
behind the
curtain. Actually, no, I'm sorry. It's the end of June. That was the end of May. So by the end of this month, we'll be 27 years.
Awesome. Very nice.
Early congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Now, our first real date was on the 4th of July. Like, the first time we planned to meet somewhere. No, I'm getting this off. That's the third date. That's the third date.
Because our first date.
The first date, we went into the city, because you said Harlem.
I sure did.
Went into the city. We went to the Speakeasy, which was still there as a building, but not called the Speakeasy anymore. Down by the West Village.
Sure.
What else is by there? The falafel joint, Mammon's, that everybody goes to. And
yeah.
And
like near Bleecker Street, maybe? Or
Yeah. Right down
there.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So I got her drunk on melon balls.
We did. You were drunk, too.
Now, I had a friend. There was a band.
It didn't
remember?
Take much,
it was
really.
A punk band called Youth Gone Mad.
Sounds familiar.
Okay. Now we're going to be playing like Kevin Bacon type games. Okay. How about this? In the late 80s, around the Morton Downey Jr.
I remember
period.
Those days. W-O-R. I used to watch Morton Downey.
There was an artist named Ine Kostabi, also known as the con artist, who broke Morton Downey's thumb.
Oh.
Boy, I want to say
that
actually remember
familiar.
This.
Okay.
I think I heard
yeah.
that in East Coast Rocker or Kerrigan, whatever it was at the time.
Okay. Ine Kostabi is a modern artist.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things why they call him the con artist is because he doesn't necessarily paint his own pictures, which is what many famous artists do who had shops, you know, they knew what they wanted, but they didn't necessarily want to do all the grunt work. So they would have assistants paint stuff and then they would finish. And that's a sense. But he made no bones about it. And he made it. He would design thematic styles. And then he had a fucking shitload of artists beneath, under him that would paint the pictures, but yet still commanded, you know, thousands of dollars, and, you know, of course, you know, like Stallone bought one. Huh. It was like an abstract nude.
Okay.
And so this guy made a comment in the news like, oh, fucking Stallone figures he'd buy a picture of tits and ass. Stallone sent it back. So he said, great, now I'll sell it to someone else and charge twice as much because Stallone used
had
to.
It.
Smart. So he was that kind of guy. And so they called him the con artist. They said he was very much in the Andy Warhol plus, you know, he was taking. His brother, Mark Kostabi, was in Youth Gone Mad, which was one of the first punk bands with a Gone Mad. Apparently.
Yeah.
He and that band dissolved, but then reappeared. And my high school friend, Josh Yarrington, was on the drums. And Josh and I were friends, and we're same grade, so we really knew each other. And we were both drummers, so we had that connection. So we went up to his place, where he lived with the bass player, which was in Spanish Harlem, when Spanish Harlem was Spanish Harlem.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
You know, it was. And I remember that we got off. This is a very different city. We were going up to like, he was like on 176 or something like that. Mm-hmm. It was way up there.
Yeah, it was way up there.
And we take the bus and we get off, and I think we got off like 10 blocks too early or some shit. No, literally, we're walking through the neighborhood and I heard a bunch of black guys go, ooh, white people. I was just like, just keep moving forward. But as Josh said, you know, once you live in the area, they just, you know, you're part of the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so. That's absolutely true.
But however, your friends coming in and out are not those people. Until,
right.
Until
right.
You're like
you're
on
outsider,
the block.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, yeah. That was sort of that was our experience that night.
Wow.
Your Harlem thing touched off that story.
It sure did.
And then I had to call my dad and tell him I was in Harlem.
Yeah. He had nice. To. Yeah. She's, oh, where are you?
Harlem.
But meanwhile, you're like 20 years old. You know what I mean? Like.
I was.
You need
I
to know where
still,
you were.
Where,
you're
19.
20 years old. You're fucking.
I was 19, but he still wanted to.
You're still work. Legal. Meanwhile, you're out drinking melon balls.
Yeah, so. But he wanted to know where it was. So. I was
City.
A good girl.
So why were we talking about Harlem? We went there.
Well, we were talking about the club scene and
yeah, how it's changed. That's all.
There's nothing there. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that would be my problem with. You know, getting a band together and all that kind of shit. It's like, where are you going to play?
Yeah.
It's either the New Jersey cover scene.
Yes.
Yeah, that's really died, though. Like, you know, I know
compared
you,
to
you
the,
guys are playing,
no,
but like the amount
the,
of venues that you can play at now is...
It's limited, yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, no,
so, like,
yeah.
Yeah, I'm doing this like...
So
you know,
as a cover...
See it on the pod.
Are you in the same... Do you move in the same circles as the nerds?
No.
So you don't have that. Are you not under that locked in management that they?
Hey,
no, I've had management in the past. Like I've been with Stars Entertainment.
Okay. Yeah,
I've been 107 Productions.
Yeah.
So I used. Do you know Chris?
Over at where at Stars or
over at Logical Lighting?
No, I do not actually.
Okay.
Why he was
Well, he did the Morristown Community Theater.
Okay.
Which is now whatever the fuck it is, and I think he still has that gig. But he also did a lot of star shit.
Oh, okay.
He was in the area.
Yeah, I don't, whatever. Our manager's name was Lisa. And I don't even remember her last because it was so long ago. It's like
that was,
ancient
that
history.
That was what work, and I ended up working, I had a sound company at one point, and basically he would throw me shit. You know?
Oh,
so,
good.
Yeah,
yeah. You do sound mixing for bands, right?
Yeah, but, and
yeah.
Lights, because I had this gear from having a band. So right. Like, mm-hmm. why don't I help other people?
Sure.
You know? It's usually lights too that everybody wants, because everybody invests in sound. It's lights that they you know, everybody doesn't invest in.
No, true.
And now if you did it, you need all LEDs. You have to fucking reinvest.
Yep.
I remember, man. I was like, fuck. Anyway, another reason to get out. But then you get into film and you're back in the same shit.
That's right.
It's amazing.
It's the quicksand.
So as a So you that sewn up the Stars thing where they had all the cover band clubs sewn up, that was such a bullshit.
Oh, I agree.
It was
with
like
you.
A monopoly. It was a strange
shit.
Monopoly.
Yes, that's so true. That's like because you'd approach clubs like, oh no, it's locked. Too,
we only
stars.
Go through Stars.
Yes.
Yep. Well, and
early 90s,
but here's
it was
the,
just...
but they do have a case to make.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Nerds walks in. I pay them $5,000. I know I'm going to fucking like make a million or however much in fucking bar tab.
Yes, correct.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's just like Kevin. Kevin gets $10,000 or whatever to walk into a place. The place knows that they're going to get that back in spades because he always sells out.
Yes.
That was the Stars thing. But there were some bands on that roster that I doubt did that.
Correct.
You had Nerds, everyone else.
Yeah, there were then like the Benjamins were part of that.
Was
like,
Voices.
Voices, that was there.
Monty. Yes.
Well, that was Voices. Dog Voices because dog Monty voices. Came from That's Who Brought the Dog.
Yeah.
And then he combined
all
with Voices.
All this Jersey cover band politics.
Welcome everyone to Jersey cover band theater.
Frightening. The fact that this even, and I know what the fuck you're talking about is, and I only know it because I was in that sound part of the business.
Right, right.
Because I hated all, as a musician, I wasn't any of that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
There were a lot of politics, I can tell you that. I mean, you know.
And I remember the last time I sat down at a drum set and tried to fucking learn a cover roster. I made my mixtape up. I sat at the drum set and I was like,
were you dying inside or?
And there were songs I liked too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, by track two, I knew. I was like, I can't do this.
Yeah.
I can't just play someone else's fucking
shit. You have to do originals.
I am dead inside. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And
I get that. Believe me.
I think what I learned from that was I'm an artist, not a musician.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like, I can't. A musician to me can look at a sheet of music and put passion to it. You know?
Right.
You know, it's like a performing monkey in some respects.
Yeah.
Put themselves in it.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. I'm not that guy.
Yeah,
you know? I need to create something and be familiar and love it, and then I'm more happy with it.
Yes.
Then I can
and
play
boy,
it again
I
and again.
That. I really do. You know.
Yes. And as a result, I got no work.
Yeah, it's exactly because, you know, I have friends that are
passion.
In the original scene, and it's like, okay, here's your money for the night, $35 split between four people. You know, it's like, meanwhile, like, you know,
so true.
Cover and bands are getting so much more, and that's the whole thing.
And guess what? You're about to pay the PA guy half that shit.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Or the light guy or whatever the fuck.
Right.
Yes, I've taken bands' money like that.
Right.
I've been like, I've seen them get their money and been the shit dog who's like, yeah, I need my money now.
Yeah. Because I think it's predicated, right, with these original bands of how many people you bring, you know? It's,
that's... Oh, the ticket system.
Yeah. Well, how many people can you bring?
Do you remember Obsessions?
Yeah, that was, where the hell was that? What town was
that? Was right down here. That was on Sussex Turnpike.
Yes.
Right off.
I went to see. I forgot who that guy saw there.
If you keep drawing, that was.
Well, that's a name out of. Now it's like flood. All the memories are flooding back.
I know, isn't it amazing?
Because I was like, wow, I remember that place, and I forgot who I went to go see there.
They would have national acts every now and then,
right?
But most of the time, it was the dirge of sell the tickets bands.
Mm.
Dude, because of Penny, Chris Penny from fucking, you know, Dillinger and all that shit.
Yeah,
his early bands. We did it once or twice, but we hated it because we hated selling tickets.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we were just like,
oh,
really?
It's demeaning, you know?
So much so.
Is this what it's really all about?
You're begging your friends to come, you know?
Yep.
Like, and as anyone knows, Jesus said it best, a prophet will never be recognized in his hometown. So none of your friends think you're good, no matter what, because you're their friend.
Right.
They're like, that fucking jerk off, who does he think he is? You know what I mean? So they don't want to see you. That's a chore to them. So you can't sell tickets to your friends.
Right.
Or they'll buy them and not show up, which is worse.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Which is so much worse, which was like our last experience there.
Oh, no.
You had like three friends that showed up?
No, we sold the amount of tickets we needed to sell, but literally none of them showed up.
Oh. What a slap in the face, you know?
I know. And then they do shit like, the guy who sells the most tickets, they get to pick where they are in the lineup. And they always pick the first position. So guess what happens? You don't even get a crack at anyone else's audience. Because they just stay for their friends.
Yeah,
and
then they split. I know. I've seen this happen, actually.
And then
so right.
Oh, God. It was so fucking bad.
Wow.
Oh, my God. And so this is the last time we played it. On top of that, I don't know what I was thinking, but like, I guess I was in a good mood. I had bumped into a guy. I was going to CCM at the time, taking classes at CCM, County College of Morris, for those who don't know. Harvard on the Hill.
As opposed to ours, Bergen Community College, Harvard by the Highway.
You know. Bergen Comedy College, we used to call it.
The Hill, the
Highway.
Well,
the reason why is because anyone who's ever gone there knows it's a long-ass fucking hill. You had to walk. In the old days, you had to walk up because that's where the parking lot was. So you literally like have a coronary walking up this long path.
You need like a mini bike to get up.
Yeah,
as opposed to Bill on the Hill, William
so, Patterson. You know, I was in a class with this guy, and I guess maybe he saw a T-shirt I had. It was Blues Traveler or some shit. And we did a cover of a Blues Traveler song. We did, but anyway. And and so he's like, yeah, I play harmonica. This is where I learned. You never trust someone
this.
At face value.
I remember this.
Because I was from a world where if you say you played something.
That means you played.
You played something. I was spoiled at that point. Like, the best guitarist I've ever played with lived two doors up, literally.
Oh, my God.
And that's how we met and eventually played together. So I didn't realize how spoiled I was when I went out into the world and found other musicians who sucked. But anyway, so this guy said he played harmonica. So, and I said, well, obviously you're not going to play as good as John Popper, but, you know, are you good? He's like, yeah. He was not.
Oh, boy.
Not at all.
He had a harmonica.
Was that song you did more intricate than Runaround? Or?
He had a harmonica is a very accurate description of
he got
how
out
much
of a cereal box.
He played. No, I mean, it was probably like a marine band.
Oh, okay.
And it probably was the right key.
Oh,
you know what's amazing? I have the cut.
It's oh,
like,
yeah.
It's I wish like you could play it.
I can. It's one of the worst moments ever in Pro Jack history, I think. I hope I have it.
Maybe you could do pitch correction on it.
Oh, no.
Get T-Pain at it.
It's much better. It's much better in its raw, unadulterated form. Uncut.
Warts and all.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And ooh. Talk about warts. And also, this, okay.
Genital warts.
I'm going to give a lot of premise, and I hope, for God's sake, the track is here. Because it was a board. It's like, it was another one of these things, because anywhere you leaked, this fucking club hung a bucket. So if you wanted a fucking recording of your set, another $20 or whatever the fuck it was for them to literally put a cassette in a recorder and hit record for your fucking like five songs you got to do, whatever the fuck, that you sold thousands of dollars worth of tickets. This guy is now making money on you for his booze or soda or whatever the fuck, because when he had teen night.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, this guy was so fucking brilliant. He built the club in two sections.
Teen night.
Oh, and so one
an
was for
inner,
teenagers.
An inner and outer ring. Yes.
Right.
Where in a sense, only the teens could be in what was a cordoned off section where they could only get sodas
they
and all that shit.
Allowed.
And then there was the outer section that had the bar, and so that never the two could meet.
Oh, wow.
So that
wow.
he could have more teen nights and make more fucking money.
Oh my
Billy
God.
Knew how to make a fucking dollar.
I remember China Club up in Hillsdale used to have
a teen
night.
Yes, right.
Yeah, I remember like seeing bands that were like what was it, Virgin Surgeon and the Hellcats like years ago. Yeah, it's like oh my God.
We played.
It's so funny because recently Kevin was talking about a teen night that he went to. Mm-hmm. And where the fuck was it? He even did the chant. Was it fast? Because we would all know it. It was one of those clubs that we've all. Mm-hmm. If you didn't go there, you at least knew what it was.
Yeah.
It was down at the shore. It was one of these places that did a teen club. Was it Fast Paced or Fat?
I don't remember.
Because Kevin was like, he dropped this obscure reference. He was like, he did the little chant. Mm-hmm. And yet he still got a reaction from the crowd as if they knew what the fuck he was talking about because he's in California. He's like, wow, how'd that get a laugh?
You know, there was a club, I want to say it was Morristown that we played, and I believe, so it was attached to a strip club, Double D's. Do you remember this?
Yes.
So it was so
oh
great.
Everybody,
so like, you know, all the rock dudes were playing out, you know, jamming out, and then we're done, and smart enough, we all go next door to Double
of course.
D's. what a brilliant idea.
What was the name of that club? What the fuck was
that?
And
I played it, and I can't even remember it.
A period in the 90s where that was sort of the place to be.
Yes, and they had national acts there, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Signed acts.
Yes, they started getting another place that got national acts.
What the hell? Hammer? No, I'm thinking of an...
I can't... As soon as you say it, I'll know.
If I look up Double D's like on the internet, I guarantee you'll find the club name.
There may be like 50 people from Jersey going, that's club, you moron!
You idiot!
Yeah, that was another...
Wasn't that the premise of Joe's Garage from Zappa?
That was also... I believe that's right by where WDHA...
I think you're absolutely right about that.
And still there. I don't know what it calls itself, but that broadcast station. And
yeah,
spot
I think it
is still
DHA.
Okay.
I remember being younger and always wishing that the signal came in
we
better.
We drive past it all the time to take our daughter to dance.
I remember like another embarrassing place that we played was a club that was attached to a bowling alley. and it'd be so funny because, you know, we'd finish like
where?
A, I can't remember. Again.
Was in Denver?
And then the name of the band was the men from Nantucket. Very, very clever. So we would like, you know, we'd finish a song like Green Day, like Time of Your Life. And it'd be like, I hope you had the time of your life. You know, the bowling ball hitting the pins.
Dude.
It was like, I am living strike. Spinal Tap right
I
now.
Have,
you know?
I have, dude, I have some. I have
horror
some,
stories?
Not even
I told
horror
them,
stories.
Spinal Tap, but pin
like,
puppet show.
But like, there was this shithole called Joanne's. And as much as
where's that?
Shithole. I'll explain in a minute.
Yeah.
It was a mine hill.
And that bar, by the way, is called Tiki Bar. At Double D's.
Really?
That
doesn't sound
called,
familiar.
No, it was called something else before that.
I think it
that.
Changed hands. It was something
yeah,
before
it was something
okay.
else before that. Because I remember it being like a fucking person's last name kind of thing. You know, like a one-word name.
Johnson's?
Like, Arthur's is jumps to mind, Arthur's. But that's a steak place. But yeah. it wasn't
yeah.
that.
Oh, okay.
I can find out, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was what I found.
Yeah, I remember when it was the bee's knees, man. It was a place to be.
So Joanne's, though.
Joanne is a little shithole. Now... but they had a pool table in it. And it's not like they closed up the pool table when the band came on. Mm-hmm. So we have these great some great tapes of us playing, and it's great and it's awesome, and the song ends and you hear some cheering, and then crack, crack, yeah, the fucking pool table going off and shit. It's just like,
oh
man, so much
God.
For those cheers. You know, it sounds like the little shit bar we were in. You know, you can't, it's not Madison Square Garden by any stretch of the imagination. You can't even get it there as soon as you hear those, or, you know, like people in conversations laughing.
Right.
Like, and it, you know, has nothing to do with you, but it sounds like they're laughing at the band.
It's like, woo-hoo. What?
Because a lot of, I have a friend who was, we were both tapers, but since I was in the bands, he would come and tape our stuff. The one good thing is since he passed, I now have like tapes with him saying shit on it. So he never really goes away.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is very cool. Another cool thing about that Dead. Are you into the Dead at all?
No. I mean,
I am.
I don't even want to pretend to be like.
Good.
Well, I watch AMC. You know, like. Ray
I recognize their place. In musical history, but yeah.
As I was watching a 6-part doc dropped on Amazon, exclusive on the Grateful Dead, but as I was watching it, and as I hear them talk about their musical experience. All I can think to myself is I am so glad the Grateful Dead are part of my musical experience because there is something that they do and did. They summed it up so quickly and I didn't even realize where it came from. Jerry Garcia came from bluegrass because he was a banjo player.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
He liked that in bluegrass, the instruments talked to each other.
Huh.
Take that. Very simple concept. You know, mm-hmm. ding, 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 ding,
yep,
ding, ding,
yep.
ding.
Doing banjos.
Right.
Yeah. But they do more than that. I mean, that's literally call and response. If you ever listen to bluegrass, mm-hmm. it's a lot of instruments playing off each other and constantly doing shit. And you can tell that they're listening to each other and like they are talking.
Right.
He wanted to apply that to rock. Hence, jam bands were born. You know what I mean?
Huh.
It's like fucking like. Yeah, let's take elements of jazz, but really, he was taking it from bluegrass, which I never would have thought.
Oh, crap.
Did
the Grateful Dead predate the Allman Brothers? Do you know where they came out around the same time?
Around the same time, but I think they probably predate.
Yeah,
them. Not by much.
Just because, I mean, I think
well,
they're
they
kind of talked of in the
they
same.
They were the Warlocks,
sort of. Yeah.
Mm.
And then that they had heard another band had the name the Warlocks,
mm-hmm.
and may have even recorded something. Now, it turns out that band also changed their name to the Velvet Underground, so.
Oh, yeah, with
Oh, there
Reed.
We go.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah. Little,
interesting little. Stuff.
Yeah, it was a good doc. But I'm very glad because jam bands, to me, that's where another bit of, if you're in music, that's where your future lies. That's because.
Life. Fish is a perfect example.
Exactly. But
very true.
They're sort of the Dead too.
Yes, mm. right,
but,
exactly.
But what's so cool is there's parts of the
You've
thing where Jerry is saying,
fishes.
You know, I hope that this thing that we've created transcends us. Like it's like that.
It wasn't exclusive to them.
Yeah,
this
model that we've figured out, which is, oh, we listen to each other. and we jam, and if you are a musician, some point, listen to some good live Dead. Put aside all prejudice, and you hear like six amazing players playing off each other. Like fucking Bob Weir reinvented how to play rhythm guitar. Yeah. No doubt, if you've ever... So, I have a lot of passion for the Dead. And I'm very glad they're in my musical.
We couldn't tell.
Because once you apply... Because I... My band, the band that I ended up being in that was my best band, didn't sound anything like the Grateful Dead.
Mm-hmm.
But we applied aspects of that model.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to grunge. We never got to fully realize it, but, you know, that's the way we would have went.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't bore you. You know what I mean?
Quick question, Scott. Did you ever get to see the Dead live? Or?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Quite a few times. That's what Mark and I had in common, which was at like at the core, I think, of our friendship, was that we were both Deadheads. Once we knew that about each other, at the end of this documentary, this guy says it best. I loved it. It actually brought a tear to my eye. He's like, you know, I think that I would have more in common with a Deadhead 500 years from now than I do with anyone just walking around today. And the guy asked why. He goes, because I would just know something deeper about them. And I was like, oh my God, that is so true. And then he went on to say that he meets Deadheads today that have never seen the Dead, have never had that opportunity. So they've only listened to stuff and whatever. And he says that, you know, they are just as much a Deadhead. You know, they're just as much members of the club because they get it as any other Deadhead. And if there was anything that he could relieve them of, is the burden to feel, is that feeling that they missed it because they didn't. It's now.
Yeah.
Huh. And I was like, oh my God, oh, I'm crying.
I missed it. I never got to see Jerry.
Yeah,
I
she
didn't.
Nor did I.
She saw tons of fish, though, with me.
Oh, my God, fish.
See, what happened? It's so weird. In 1989, I saw Blues Traveler Wetlands.
Oh, they're amazing.
Oh, wow.
Blues Travelers are amazing.
I was a Deadhead. Still am. I mean, you know. But at that point, I was like, wow. If this were the 60s, this is what I'd want to see. Like, this is now. This is the Dead, but now. I want this, you know? And so we started following those fuckers, going there all the time, and then Fish, and then all these new bands came. So I stopped seeing the Dead because, you know, you only have so much money and so much resources.
Right.
I would see them every now and then if someone flipped me a ticket, but I spent more of my time in there with my own band, and, you know, that whole thing happened. So.
Yeah.
But I'm so glad the Dead are part of my history. Who would you say is part of your musical history, sir?
I mean, Queen is a huge
part. Me too. First band I ever heard.
Yeah.
In my life.
Like, I mean, you know, growing up, it was like that. Those were like the records I was. The Beatles. Yeah.
I was gonna say,
very much so.
See, yeah, it's weird because we kind of grew up in the wake of the Beatles. I had a friend of mine who was like maybe 10, 20 years older than me at the time, and he'd say it was like when you ask somebody who's your favorite band, the qualifier was besides the Beatles.
Right.
Yeah, because that was just like it was
a given.
Yeah, everybody's there.
Yeah. I know. It seems like the go-to answer, but just
well, it certainly was back then, like 20, 30 years ago.
So, yeah,
you know, on the school bus, as he said.
Right. And were you a Stones and Who fan, or
you know, it's funny as a drummer. Well, I was always a contrarian, and I was always a bit of like, oh, is that who you like? Fuck you, I like this guy. So Stuart Copeland was probably my biggest drum influence.
Well, it's a good influence to have.
Everyone I knew was in the Neil Peart. And it's not that I didn't like them, but it's kind of like the same thing I had about 24. I've never seen 24, and I will never see 24 because all these motherfuckers have told me how good 24 is. And just it wouldn't let up. And the funny thing is, at one point, I was ready. I was going to see 24. I was all good. But that one more motherfucker came up to me and told me how good it was and how much I was going to love it. I was like, I am never fucking watching this show. Ever.
You got to have principles.
Yes. And I have
it. To you out there that did it, you ruined it.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll show you. Now I'm not going to watch it.
Exactly. And you know what? I don't give a shit about the glorification of that bullshit anyway. You know, like, in 24 hours, he can, like, oh, I'm going to torture the terrorist and all that kind of crap. So.
Mm-hmm. Rinse, cycle, repeat.
Yeah.
It's the same.
It all occurred in 24 hours, and yet he hasn't showered or anything. And
now, I want to go back to Queen, because Freddie Mercury, to me, is the number one frontman ever.
Absolutely.
I agree, 100%. Definitely. And more than that, he's an amazing tenor.
He's so amazing. Like, he brings tears to my eyes.
He's got more range than any tenor I've
ever
heard.
He really does. He brings tears to my eyes.
The range.
And to anyone who's listening, I mean, go on YouTube and just type in the search field the isolated tracks of Freddie Mercury on, if you want to see, absolute brilliance.
Like,
here's the funny, like, seriously, as I remember being six and I got the record player that was like denim covered, but with fucking, the denim wasn't denim, it's like contact paper.
Right.
You know, it looks like the woven seat, back pocket thing on the top. And opening that fucker up and also getting the Welcome Back Cotter 45 case.
Good Lord.
Oh my God.
Nice.
And in it was
a
starter set of 45s. This was my parents one Christmas.
Was this your first record?
This was, my first record player and my first
vinyl.
Oh my God,
yeah.
Cool.
My brother had some.
Have fun.
And the first one that I busted out.
Mm-hmm.
Was Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. And for whatever reason, I knew it somehow, either from my
first time,
parents playing it on the radio.
Incredible.
And as fucking stupid as it was, sitting there singing into the hairbrush, I knew that's what I wanted to do.
Wow.
Yeah, it was fucking like, I wanted to sing like Freddie.
Yeah.
Oh my God, Freddie Mercury blows my mind.
Yeah.
So
that's why to this day, I can't sing unless I'm full. All out, 100%.
That's what he does.
Because that's what he does.
Yes, he gave it his all.
And,
yeah.
Every time I find a singer like that, I'm always attracted to them.
Yeah.
Like, a classic example is fucking Jack Black. Jack Black sings balls out from the fucking back end diaphragm like nobody's business. And most people don't even realize that, but he's fucking powerful.
He's true. Got a great voice.
Yeah. I remember Bone Crushing Juggernaut. The first cover band we formed that kind of got me back into music in Virginia. That's where the name comes from. It was four guys who were too old to be doing this shit kind of thing, like trying to recapture their youth from 10 years ago. And at that point, I was overweight and unhappy with where I was. I knew I could never be a front man again, which was total bullshit. But
you had that in your mind at the time.
Yeah, so I resigned myself to get back into the drums like I never had been before. And so that's what I did. And God, now I forgot this fucking point of the story. I was going somewhere.
It'll come to you, don't worry.
Bone Crushing Juggernaut, singing. Oh, yeah. Finally, one day, they were like, oh, guys, I want to try and sing a song. Now, our singer was lousy, so he was very intimidated by that.
Oh, my God.
But, you know, I couldn't help it. And so I just let it out. And everybody was like, whoa, what the fuck happened here? So
the singer got fired.
Things got really rough after that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So Bone Crushing Juggernaut did not end well.
Oh.
Yes. It's one of those stories of guys who are, you know, who've become sober and are learning how to be good people and don't know how to act when each other, you know, are all fucking over each other. Like, nobody knows how to act. And everybody's like, this is fucked up. Anyway.
Right.
In the old days, we would drink and everything would be fine.
God. I still remember that.
I'm spiraling.
Yeah, we used to, jam down in my basement years ago, before Pete was on the band scene.
What do you play?
Guitar.
Guitar.
Oh, yeah. Wait a minute here, buddy.
But
I had no idea.
Yeah.
So why are you not saying this? Why? I'm talking I got one musician here and I got a nobody.
Like our theme song. That's me on guitar. That's Pete singing.
Yes.
See, I didn't know that. So you play. How long have you played?
On and off since I was like 16. But you know, like I'm not.
Have you played in bands? That's a big. See, here's what I know. My brother is an awesome guitar player. And he's been playing guitar fourth grade, fifth grade.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, he's got all the
talent. He's really good.
He's never played in bands.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very
it's a different
musician.
Yeah.
You can't, it's very, I can't play with my brother. It's very hard because he doesn't, he's not used to structure. And, you know, like beginnings and endings and making those tight. Because there's a lot more, you know, noodling.
I've played live a couple of times, but I've never been in a quote band. It's just we had our basement band thing that we were just doing every week.
Of course.
Yeah, like, it was fun, myself, our friend
Guy.
Again,
that band experience, except for maybe you didn't have a crowd or an audience. Right.
Although a couple of times we did.
We
actually had people hang out.
Okay, so was there enough people that you felt a distinctive buzz as a result? Because that's when you know there was enough people.
I don't know. It was a basement, so how many people can you get down there?
There were cardboard cutouts, I'll be honest.
Because here's the key to really good live music is what the Dead knew. The audience affects it.
Yeah, the playoff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so
you're saying your feet off the audience?
Yeah.
I could not agree more with that.
100%.
Yes.
But the Dead would try and take that to the next, you know, would, that's why they didn't have set list per se. And they didn't have, you know, they would, I mean, Phil Lesh is like, dude, all you had to do was listen. I'd be listening.
Manipulating
and for some reason, I'd hear a melody line float into my brain, you know, and like, and I've been there too. It's the same experience where everybody hears it. A good song is just plucked from the universe. Like you can just tell.
Yeah.
Like it's like it was already written. You're just kind of divining it out.
It's just,
you know?
Where did it come from?
Right. Yeah.
But it's there.
Yeah. Like yesterday being ham and eggs. You know what I mean?
Yep.
It's
scrambled eggs.
It was already there, you know? Like it was just needed to be revealed. That shit is so amazing to me. And that's where, I don't know, the human experience really becomes fun to me. That you have to play with the crowd as a player. Until you experience that, you're not really a musician. No offense to people who play in their bedroom.
Oh, yeah.
Right, right.
I think it's where I'm going with that.
And we're talking the instrument, not the other play.
Yeah, well, you can play with that all you want. That's fine, too.
That's a different instrument.
Yes.
But are you considered a musician?
Of the skin flute, perhaps.
A maestro. Yeah.
At that
the
point,
maestro
probably,
of the male organ.
I'm a virtual
I'm probably all
master.
Men. I'm sure all men are maestros of that.
Yes, indeed.
Like conductors, right?
They're conductors.
Yeah, exactly.
No, but I'm
Carnegie Hall.
Going back to the basement, I remember like the one time we were just like fucking around. And I started, you know, like playing around with the beginning of Fat Bottom Girls.
I love that.
And, you know, it's D. It's like, you know, like, ding. And it's like, all of a sudden, Pete starts singing. It's like, you know, you gonna take me home? And it's like, and it's just like, we all just like stopped and like looked like, what?
Where did that come from?
Holy crap. Okay. We're gonna learn this song now.
Yeah. He was a huge influence, Freddie.
What key that's in.
You know? What key?
Yeah.
Oh, God. I am not sure. It's not drop D, that's for sure. Bring out the tablature.
G.
They do have some weird key songs.
Oh, yeah.
Queen, yeah.
Well, I think that one was in drop D, though. I think.
Was it? Maybe you're right about that.
I think Fat Bottom Girls really is supposed to be in drop D.
Not, but
I played it in standard tuning,
yeah,
you know, I got away with it.
What key would drop D be? An F? F?
It
F,
might
F
be.
Not major.
I like the way you said that.
It's just I just remember the chords. That's it.
Yeah.
Are you gonna take me home tonight?
Wow, alien.
Okay, then.
Not quite. That right, and probably not in the
is
right.
Is it higher? The key sounds
it's
low.
D major.
Right?
Yeah.
It's D major.
Yeah, I have it in F.
I usually.
Are you gonna take me home tonight?
Closer.
Nice. I like it.
And a choir of angels came in. No.
There we go.
You're getting there. Yeah. Wow.
Are you gonna take me home tonight?
Featuring Beelzebub.
I think we're done. are you gonna? There we go. then it's setting the right group of chorus behind it. There's so many options. Me. You, you gonna take me home tonight? And then you do this.
I'm hearing voices. No.
I am. What's her face? Cher is in the room with
Cher.
Do
you believe in life after love?
There you go.
Yes, Pete is also a Cher impersonator.
Wow. That's an alien Skid Row.
We are the youth, come on.
And not the band.
Oh, God, anyway, Sebastian.
That's an awesome effect there.
You know, at some point, there's quite a collection. At some point,
were you going through like phasers and flangers? No, yeah. Yeah.
I was going through a harmonizer.
Harmonizer.
A detuner, and then just an exciter.
Exciter.
The exciter's good.
Oh, my God, remember
dude,
them?
60 bucks.
I saw them at the Capitol Theater.
Dude, you want to spend $60 to make your vocals sound great on stage, like EQ wise?
Yeah.
This pedal right here.
What is it? Hold on.
It is.
Oh, a voice tone, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
I'll have to check into that.
It's two knobs, and that button adds, like, as if you were in a tube amp. Adds it warmth.
Oh, wow.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Huh.
As opposed to that one time when you guys started singing at, what the hell was that, the doghouse? The one up in,
Yes.
Washington Township.
Terrible room.
where the effects were on your voice.
Oh,
and like...
yeah, and I sound like an alien. Yeah.
Let me go back to
that.
My real mic here.
There we go.
If you've ever been, like, on stage and you just felt like, God, my vocals sound like shit. I wish I could tweak them.
That's a good pedal
like,
to have.
Like, yeah, it's like bam. You could just.
I'm gonna have to. My brother works for Guitar World, so he'd be able maybe to hook me up with that.
And
with
it's not
pedal.
Of their line. That's probably the cheapest one to do.
Really, and only 60 bucks, huh?
65 or
60.
Like
yeah,
that.
That's more than reasonable.
Yeah, yeah.
So. I'll look into it.
Just a simple trick. One of those tips. Voice tone, folks.
Right?
Now you're learning all the secrets.
Voice tone.
They learn all the secrets of the trade. Now they know how I get my Bane sounds.
No!
No!
Subtitled Bane. That's what we needed.
We right? can't tell them that.
That's really good.
I forget. I'm in the wrong mic.
Can't. We can't tell them that. I'm in the wrong mic. Oh, Bane! That's my name. Say it once, you say it again. Bane! Thank you.
Yes.
Motherfucker.
Yes, as we played the Bane game.
Yes. There was some Bane recently on Edumacation.
There was. That was a good one.
Tom Hardy.
Yes. Tom Hardy, now Venom as well.
Yes.
Yes, I did hear about
and
that.
And recently, yes, I got an Oh, yes, I should mention that too. We got mailed in an edumacorrection. I don't remember who it is, and I'm so sorry.
Oh, boy.
But it was a name... What makes me happy is a name that I didn't, I don't know. It was new. And they were saying, oh, by the way, I want to correct you because when you announced that, I said Spawn instead of Venom.
Ah, gotcha.
I had Venom 100% in my mind.
But you said Spawn.
But I was saying Spawn at the time. So thank you for the correction, sir.
Well,
thank you for listening.
Aren't they going to be doing another theatrical version of Spawn or something?
Well, Kevin is going
to
be involved.
Hang on. Yes. Spawn on
theatrical.
Broadway.
You did say it, theatrical.
Wait, isn't Kevin involved in a series about Spawn's?
Yeah.
Oh, the two
really?
Those side guys.
Yeah. Isn't he involved?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah.
But like Kevin, a lot of stuff gets announced. That just sort of like, where did that go? Where's this? Where's that last comic? What's going on?
Clerks 3.
Where's that? Well, some things are beyond Kevin's control.
Right, I know. It's not his fault. No.
We can bust his balls, though, for the things that are.
Yeah.
Like, when's the end of that Batman series?
Oh, God.
Let's see. How many times has DC rebooted itself since that?
Oh, let's see. You had the New 52. Now you had Rebirth. Now it's like...
Is there a third? Are they done with Rebirth and going to reboot themselves again? It's like... It seems
Rebirth
to be...
Rebirth 2.
It seems to be like...
Battle of...
Multi-universe in, multi-universe
it's
out.
It's the...
Multi-universe
Crisis on Infinite Earth. It's like, oh, we have too many universes. we're going to compact them back in the 80s.
That was the first one, yeah.
And then it's like, okay, now let's just blow that to shit again. And it's like, okay, well, hold on, Flashpoint. This is what we can do. Okay, we're going to just rewrite everything.
Here's one area where I do believe... There's one area where I always felt it actually makes more sense, I think, for them to have their own universe, which is why in film I don't mind. X-Men. X-Men make more sense independent. If you don't have other fucking superheroes running all over the place. Because if you're going to hate on a superhero for being a mutant, what the fuck difference is a mutant and Spider-Man and all
right,
that?
Right, yeah, it's like, it never altered makes... human versus mutant versus, I don't, you know, like Asgardian God or whatever.
I doubt that human's pecking order would go that deep. You know what I mean?
it's like, you're great, Captain America, but you're a mutant.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's like... I don't think they have that much wherewithal. And what is the difference between superhero by mutation? I mean, most scientific origins of are a mutation.
Correct.
They've just been introduced by something else. So I always thought that was kind of stupid. Even as a kid, I saw through that one.
I could see that.
I was like, why are mutants? Like, not just, huh? Why are they not treated like fucking Spider-Man?
Besides J. Jonah Jameson always being on Spider-Man.
Yeah, okay.
Besides the point. Yeah.
Even though he's a different universe, I was a kid, Superman, Batman. Why did he get this shit end?
Right.
What are they? You know, because they're mutants, therefore. Come on. Wolverine can still slice and dice.
Well, you know.
Slice and dice.
Depending on which Wolverine we're talking about, there's the... Because one of them's dead, there's Old Man Logan, then there's X-23.
I seem to recall that original Wolverine had like shish kebab claws more than blades. And I also remember them coming out of raised like metal things in his gloves. So they were more spike-like than they were more stabby than slashy.
I got what you're saying on the second one, but like now, I don't know if they were more shish kebab. I think you might be thinking of the old Spider-Man and Amazing Friends like version of Wolverine, where he talked like an Australian.
No, this is definitely in the comic. In the comic, I remember him being a
cranky. My claws are stuck. You know,
like the, and maybe it's more just the way the artist drew them. Like some people drew them more shish kebab-y, more piercing.
Been, yeah.
I don't remember bone claws ever in the comic. I remember the claws were installed as part of the original adamantium skeleton.
Right, yeah, whatchamacallit.
They were an add-on. They were a feature. They were not...
As Weapon X, the whole Weapon X
thing. Yeah. He didn't originally... He only had the ability to regenerate.
Yeah, but in... What was it? Back in the 90s when... Magneto went rogue again and like he ripped the adamantium from his body.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you saw bone claws. That's where the first, it's like, oh, we didn't know anything about this.
Yeah, this is all new.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, we just changed canon.
Yeah, it's like, hold on.
Because an artist decided
who's
to draw
a bone. Who's got the big
eraser? Yeah, you wonder, did an artist just throw that even in? It's like, I'll give him bone claws. I mean, obviously, he's got to have something under those claws, right?
Something's got to be there.
Yeah, it wouldn't just rip out the claws altogether. And bone claws are so cheesy in the fucking movies.
Mm-hmm.
So cheesy. Ooh, bones break, dude.
Let's not even go into X-Men Origins Wolverine.
I love that one.
Oh no! The pain, the horror, the terror.
We should do a fucking. We should do a goddamn talk over. What do you call it? A
Mr. commentary Sidefader, type of.
A commentary on that one alone.
Yeah, well, that's actually one of the first episodes I listened to of Flophouse.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the actual X-Men Origins Wolverine. That was one of the early ones that I had listened to, and then I went back.
I didn't even know they had that one.
Yes.
Oh, yes. See, it's weird. I know they like doing new movies, but I like when they do movies I know.
Yes.
More, you know, like when they did Superman versus Batman. Or when they, you know.
As opposed to the obscure Cage movie.
Yes, exactly.
Nicolas Cage.
Well, that is one of, I swear, that is one of my fond memories of that show, was that we got him to crack up.
Oh, yes. When you started playing the Nicolas Cage clip from War, what the hell is it called?
Lords of War.
Yeah, Lords of War, thank you.
Because I just happen to have it queued up in the soundboard. You know, it's like the only...
It's like Dan's talking, and then all of a sudden, like, you start to hear a cage creeping up from the background, like,
He's like, what is this? And he quick.
Yeah.
But I got to give it to him. He was quick on figuring out what
it was. Like,
that's a cage tone.
Right. I remember cracking up when I heard that.
I love that so much that when we were in L.A., when we were in Hollywood, at one point I said, we got to find Nicolas Cage's star. Now, it's funny because we never went and hunted for it.
Oh, my God.
But at one point, Gene looked down and said, there it is.
Oh, my God.
We were just walking, and there it was. And our son is like, he loves Nicolas Cage, just like all of us do.
Yep.
Just
in and that. So, like,
oh my God.
I'm like, you got to take a picture of me in front of this.
Oh, my God.
And then I'm like, as soon as I crept down, I'm like, I got to put on my best Cage face.
Oh my God, you look insane.
So I made this weird face, and I, you know, and literally what I did was pictured in, I said, let me open, I did a Ralph Garman, you know, like how Kevin always says, he transformed.
Yes.
I literally sat there and like envisioned, you know, Nick Cage and like fucking, what the fuck role was that? Was that Wicker Man?
Oh,
yes.
God.
Where are these? Spoiler alert, Dad.
So I just, you know, I just.
Hey, look, he could be collecting honey.
Man. I just envisioned that. I tell you, if I was doing the same way, if I was doing walking, I would go to communion because that's just crazy, batshit, crazy stuff. But yeah, and so the face came, and I sent it to those guys, and they liked and retweeted. I'm like, holy shit, that was funny.
That's great.
Love it.
Yeah,
man.
So. Yes, but Nick, did you ever see that that one clip somebody put together? It was like Nicolas Cage's agent.
No,
it's out on YouTube.
Oh, but, yeah, you sent it to me. It was funny.
Oh God, it's like, you know, Nicolas Cage, like how Nicolas Cage takes anything that crosses his desk, and it's his agent dealing with that.
I hate to say it, but any actor should. I mean,
yeah.
Look at Lawrence. I almost said Lawrence Fishburne
Lawrence
while thinking
Fishburne.
Of Samuel Jackson. I did it to myself.
Hold on, he's
going to
come
earlier.
From behind the curtain. It's like,
I was thinking Samuel Jackson, but I said Lawrence Fishburne from our conversation earlier, which was about the fact that people screwed them up, or that the guy from Fox screwed them up. And then I just did it. The irony, see? Murphy's Law pisses on me every day. but yeah, that guy takes anything, and that's why when they never thought he would say yes to Snakes on a Plane, and they offered to rewrite it, and he's like, no, leave it just like it is. I want it to be like Snakes on a Plane.
Made a lot of money.
Yeah, and a movie where, you know, it's like, oh, let the snake bite the woman on the boob. Let the snake bite the guy on the dick.
Mm-hmm. That's like how many cliche type of
exactly,
corny things
exactly,
can we have
yes,
the snakes 100%,
do? Yeah, exactly. So, and then the guy who plays video games saves the plane. So, yeah. There you go.
He was busy playing Slither, you know, like the old
trackball
game.
He should also get an award for being one of the first sort of, I don't know what you would call it, but like change up surprises so that the movie maker shows you that the stakes are high. Like, remember in, what was it, Deep Blue Sea?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
the
okay.
shark movie.
Yes.
The sharks,
yes.
Like, he's there and he's given
sharks
the,
on a plane. No.
He's literally given the inspirational speech and gets
whomp.
Exactly.
Gets so surprised, killed. Oh, yes. Everybody in the theater was like, did Samuel Jackson just fucking die?
I know.
It was, but it was so sudden. It wasn't like that fucking badass exploitation Godzilla of the guy from Breaking Bad, where it's like,
oh yeah,
he dies off camera in a locked room or some shit.
Yes.
Bryan Cranston. Dead.
Yeah, you literally they used him to exploitation to a much better.
Mm. Oh yes.
And I can't think. And I mean, it was a Ned Stark moment long before Ned Stark.
True. Yes.
Hats out. Hats off to Samuel L.
Jackson.
Jackson.
Yes.
I was going to say Lawrence Fishburne as a goof, but I figured everyone wouldn't think I was kidding anymore.
They don't even look alike. Though,
we should probably land this bitch because we've been going for 1 hour and 23 minutes, even without a sped line.
Or a
top 10.
We haven't been going that long.
Yes. I could see it right here.
Really?
Yeah.
Incredible. Wow.
When did we start? I don't even know.
1 hour and 23 minutes ago. Is that
damn.
We didn't do any spots. We didn't do anything. So, oh well. We'll live.
Yes.
So why don't you tell us what's up with your show, where we can find it one more time, and also your next gig or two for your band.
Sure. Although I don't know what the next my next gig's in Netcong, New Jersey, and that would be on Saturday, this coming Saturday. What is it? June? I have no idea.
And this show will be out by tomorrow. So
June 10th.
Yes.
Is that correct? Yeah.
That is correct.
So June 10th.
And yeah,
if you're in Jersey.
Polos like Ralph Lauren polo, except
yes, everyone must wear their
dingier and
is this under a Stars Management Entertainment?
No, it is not. We are independent contractors, actually. Yes, we do all our own bookings.
You're not,
and we don't need we don't need the man anymore. You know what I mean?
Now here's the thing: are you the guy who does that?
I do not. My drummer does.
Oh, you're so fun. See, drummers are always those guys too.
They're the
drummers and singers. They're like both the cheerleaders, man.
To go out there and
it's weird. As a drummer, here's where I think it all comes from. I have all this fucking equipment already here. I may as well get all the rest of the shit so I don't have to move it.
Okay,
It starts there, so that's where they get the PA and all the other shit.
Right, right.
And then, I think fundamentally, but then, I don't know, I think it's our nature as timekeepers. I think, I'd be like, but doing directing on a set?
Yes.
Feels to me so much like being in a band, like drumming. It's like, I know that fundamentally my role is timekeeper and mm-hmm. cheerleader. So both jobs that a drummer does.
Because right.
A drummer doesn't keep time so much as enforce emotion.
Mm.
You know, that's what most people don't understand, the trick of a good drummer. And if you can do both those things, all the more the better. And I feel like that's why I'm good at directing, because that's all you're really doing.
Yeah.
You're just kind of keeping everybody in time and keeping everybody pumped and kind of, you know, you're giving everybody enthusiasm because you want them to do a good job, because, you know, and it's just, that's the way it sort of happens. It flows that like that.
To me, it kind of sucks because, like, you know, the drummer's always kind of like in the, you know, the backdrop and all that. I mean, obviously there are other drummers that are real at the forefront, like Neil Peart and Tommy Lee, where
depends on the drummer too.
Right. Depends on the drummer. But to me, I think the drummer is one of, if not
absolutely.
The most important parts of the band, because
absolutely.
I've played with drummers that are so, and I'm sure like, you know, so phenomenal that everyone in the crowd is paying attention to them, not to my guitar player, to the bass player.
Yeah.
Because they're holding the band together. To me, that they are the anchor of the band, drummers.
I think what most people don't understand about bands, drummers, obviously, but all members, it has less to do with the talent of the players than the chemistry of the members when they are playing together.
That's a fair point.
Because, think of it. The shittiest punk band could be amazing because those guys are together, you know, and it's there. And I always sum this up as the perfect example for, and people always underrate drummers and their contribution to a band. But sometimes it is just the energy and chemistry that they contribute. They don't have to be the greatest drummer.
Mm.
When Bill Berry left REM, that band essentially fell apart and fell off the chart.
Yeah.
They couldn't write a song to save their lives. You know what I mean? They couldn't sell an album anymore.
Hey, everybody hurts sometimes.
Yeah.
Yay. That's
beautiful.
That was brilliant.
And the wind up, the bits.
Oh, my God. That was amazing. That was beautiful.
Thank you for lobbing me that
Speaking
one.
Speaking of timing, I didn't even lob it. You pulled out. You, like, plucked it from a song from the universe.
Yes.
Man, that was a beautiful pull. That was great. I don't know. But, yeah, as soon as he left the band, I mean, think about it.
So true.
They didn't start to get their groove back until the guy from Ministry became their drummer.
Oh my God, I love
Ministry.
But
they never made him the official drummer. He was just the touring guy. And I think that's part of the reason that because they made one album that was great. The next album, not so good. And then they call him the quits. And
that's what I hear Cheap Trick now without Bunny Carlos. It doesn't sound the same. I don't know.
No.
He's such a pocket drummer, that guy. You know, I mean, and not like, you know, whatever, a technical drummer, Bunny Carlos, but there's just something about that.
He was, you know, like thing, you know,
like, well, yeah, I mean,
what about the Who?
I'm saying not in, like, you know, the sense of like Neil Peart or something like that.
No, not the over technical.
Right. Yeah.
The Who. I never. You asked me about the. I never appreciated the Who as a drummer even until later in life.
Like Keith Moon,
Yeah. And
it's amazing.
Again, because he was so cliche and shoved down everyone's throat. And I wasn't all that big on The Who back then.
Really? Okay.
For whatever reason, I don't know. I thought they didn't fire my jets.
Yeah.
Later on, Like, you know, it's like that as a musician getting into things, realizing what an idiot I was, you know, how far I missed the boat on the,
right.
you know, like particularly on Keith Moon. And what's funny, what brought me to him was Mike Portnoy.
Oh, yeah, from Dream Theater. Well, wow. Formerly.
Because he did a bunch of shows with a tribute. He does tribute band shows.
Oh, my God, you have to see
And them. They recreate the kits and everything. And
they're amazing. Oh, my God.
Yeah, he's a phenomenal drummer.
Yeah, he does it with, like, fucking the guys from Mr. Big.
Yeah, right.
Oh, my
Paul
God.
Gilbert.
Yeah, Paul Gilbert.
Sheehan. And Sheehan.
Yeah, yeah. Billy Sheehan.
Billy Paul Sheehan, Gilbert. Yeah.
And then the guy from Extreme was on the vocals.
Oh, yeah.
Gary Sharon.
Yeah,
Sharon.
So it was, it was virtual who? Huh. But Sheehan was.
I
never knew how amazing
I think
that
I played that
guy
once virtual
yeah. was on the bass until watching that show.
Did they do the real thing?
They
no.
did.
I
they
love
did
that.
The, they did Tommy in its entirety.
Wow.
They,
damn.
They did all kinds of shit. They did it all.
You can get
was,
the DVD of it.
It was amazing. But
I was going to say, I got to look for
so,
that.
I think it was
here.
At BB King's.
But then,
oh, was it? On New York. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and Mike I'll show you some of it before you leave. Hmm. Mike Portnoy.
It's amazing.
Isel did another drumming video where he talked about it, or it might have been an extra footage, but he said, what I realized was it's the most physical drumming experience because
wow.
he, many times, A, he played without a hi-hat, and he played sort of around the beat. He didn't play.
Yeah.
He was the closest thing at the time, a lead drummer.
Yeah, he was like a whirling dervish, very
and,
much
and,
so.
And the same thing, each one of them were a lead this, because you think of Entwistle, he was a lead bassist. He wasn't that just
people
standard
would often
rhythm.
Say,
boom,
people
boom,
would
boom,
often,
boom, yeah.
often say that Cream were three guys riffing, but I give you The Who was three guys riffing.
Mm. Yep.
So, yes, I agree.
Huh. Yeah,
but,
amazing
but
stuff.
Moon, definitely. Oh.
Yeah, so, yeah, I came to appreciate Keith Moon later after seeing that and then actually attempting some of the shit, and I was like, holy shit, he's right.
Yeah.
And that's when I became much more of an appreciator of him.
Yeah. Well, but never too late.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I love when I fucking am able to cop something from someone else's style. I still can't play a fucking honest to God Keith Moon triplet to save my life. Yeah. But it's just not. I even talked to Chris Penny, my friend, about this, and it was more about trying to learn to play jazz.
Mm.
And here's a guy who literally wrote a book called Polyrhythmic, you know, Impressions. You know, you can buy it in the store.
Yeah.
And damn. He's like, yeah, you know, here's the thing. We didn't learn that way. We learned 4-4. We're rock guys. We came up from rock.
Right, right.
It's like my old drummer had to give me permission to not be able to play jazz.
Oh, God. That reminds me of the one video I watched with Dan.
You tell somebody independent snare and they have no idea what you're talking about.
Like it was, remember Steve Gadd?
Yeah,
for a long time, he was the drummer for Paul Simon.
Oh, yeah.
He's an amazing drummer, but...
Did he end up playing on Letterman, or am I thinking of someone else?
No. What the hell was
the Beret
that?
Guy.
Anton Figg was
the... Anton Figg, but no, before him was another guy.
Oh, wait,
who was,
I don't know
I believe
now.
Since past.
I don't know. Hmm. No, I think Gadd is
still
around.
A black
around.
Guy.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't...
His name sounds
Gadd,
very much
Gadd
familiar.
Is still around.
Okay.
But, like, my buddy was a drummer, and he was just... watching the one day, so I was watching with him a drummer instructional video, and it's like he was doing the remember late in the evening, you know, and it's like all of a sudden he grabs four sticks and he's like, oh, I guess this is what I was doing. It's like, wait, you don't know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Not all players. It's funny. Most players are not like Neil Peart.
No.
Most drummers don't want to play note for note.
Mm.
Right.
Like I, as a drummer, I knew I had general parts. And sort of, and if I had a hook, I would always remember to do that. But other than that, I wanted to be free, you know? I wanted to grace note and ghost note all over the fucking place. And just seriously, because I want to play in relation to the other players. I don't want to be locked into playing a part. I want to, if I feel that singer is doing something that, wow, that's really good, he's moving me, I should fucking back him up on that and just start hitting. Because I listen to the singer as a drummer more than I listen to most of the other band. Because I don't know what, I'm there to emotionally back him up.
Mm-hmm.
That's so funny that you say that, because my drummer says the exact same thing to me. He's like, I'm always listening to you, like
of
you.
Course,
that's
of course,
what he said,
of
yeah.
course. That's
yeah.
where the, that's where you know where the swell is. And we're the thunder, you know what I
right,
mean?
Yeah.
You know, we're the rain. So we have to be accenting you,
mm.
you know, or it doesn't work. So
yeah.
anyway. But this has been really interesting. We've gone all,
we went all over the place.
This is like
a little bit of this, a little bit of that.
This is classic podcast.
Yes.
But
stream of consciousness.
It's also when you have good talkers. I like as soon as I met you guys, I'm like, oh God. I like these guys. They can talk. They can bullshit.
The feeling is mutual.
They can They can do this game. Like they can have be on.
Well,
any
we
old
all
time.
Know that he can talk.
Yeah. That's understood.
We're not saying, hold on. Let's go to the other room.
Ouch.
Ouch.
It's a good thing we're good listeners.
That was a sweetie.
Ouch.
That was my sweetie thing.
Ouch.
That wasn't.
Who was it? It was fucking. What's
that? Wasn't an ouch.
You remember? You know who did that? Also, what's his name? Jim. Jim. T-shirt guy, Kevin's guy who designs all his patches.
Jim Edison.
Oh
or
God,
like
yes, yes.
Eddington or something. Edelston.
Yeah, Jim Edelston. No, was it Jim?
Jim. No, Jeff. Quigley.
Yes, Jeff Quigley.
Jeff Quigley. Sorry, Jeff. First grown up.
And Jim, you know we love you too.
And Edelston.
We just confused you two. We just confused you two briefly. You both.
Jim, you start with J.
They're both out of USKU Hockey League.
Yes.
So I mean that's the.
And I believe that
they both work on shirts and patches.
I believe that Midnight Smoke got to meet the hockey player, famous hockey player's dad.
Oh, you're talking about Gretzky.
Gretzky's dad.
Oh, wow.
Gretzky is part of the, you know, holy trinity of Kevin. So.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
yeah.
So he got to meet his dad.
There's Gretzky, there's Kevin, and Shecky. The holy trinity. Shecky!
But you were saying you're playing on.
Yeah,
on
I took
the
10th. I literally took a sip of coffee, and the show came to a grinding halt. That was weird. Dead space. I guess I am the talker.
Oh, and go see Iron Maiden on Wednesday.
Oh yeah.
Oh my God, you're going too.
Yeah, we are. Are you going?
Me too.
And
my brother and I. Yeah, my son, my brother,
one,
and I.
Two. We'll see you there then, man.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, me, Nick, and Anthony.
So you're going too?
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Fucking A. That
high
makes,
five.
That just makes this so much more fun.
I'm not going. Woo!
Okay.
Oh, no.
All right. We're going to easily get another 15 minutes out of this. But
the band I saw last night closed with Number of the Beast, actually.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, God.
They called Six Star Nation.
Did he hit that note?
Yes. And I
oh, my God.
The singer was really good, man. Yeah.
When Chris Penny was with Coheed, they would do Aces High. So.
Oh, yeah. Sweet.
Coheed and Cambry?
Yeah.
Get out of town. I didn't know that.
You didn't
know?
No. Yeah.
That he was in Coheed and...
Yeah, like...
one of the first incarnations or no?
No. There was... Where Josh Epstein or Epperhart?
Yeah.
Their original drummer. Him and their bass player had a lot of substance issues.
Oh, yeah,
oh,
they
okay.
did.
And,
yeah.
And there was a point where they both quit. Mm-hmm. And what's his name? The guitar player and fucking...
Yeah.
Oh,
he's a great guitar player, too.
And Sanchez is his last name. I think.
Yeah.
His first name. It's a cool name, though.
Right. The names are escaping me now, but...
As usual.
Yeah.
As been this whole episode.
That's why we work off each other, the four of us. You know?
Now
I have to find his name.
It was all actually very controversial, too, mm-hmm. because at the time, if you knew... I knew Chris Penny, you know, when he was a kid, and he was in our band.
Yeah.
He was in the band that eventually was the precursor to Dillinger, Escape Plan.
Oh, I know them too. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
I mean, that's really his brain. It's him and his other buddy that we.
Claudio is the singer.
Claudio.
That's
right.
It.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Claudio Sanchez.
Right.
He's got, like, his hair is amazing.
I know. Yeah.
So
it's like a Pantene commercial.
We jammed like Keith and Joe and I, which like were the other hair. Members of Prozac. Would jam with members of Dillinger Escape Plan before they were Dillinger Escape Plan, and
cool.
So, like one of the guys was paralyzed. He was their first bass player. And,
right. Isn't that horrible? How did he get paralyzed?
A fucking freak car accident.
No,
wow.
He was literally like bending over to get something.
No, don't do shit like that.
And was rear-ended.
Don't ever do shit
like that. And they, as a passenger, was rear-ended. Bumped into the fucking glove box.
Oh, my God.
And, like, yeah, some fracture to his spine literally left him paralyzed. Yeah.
He was the passenger?
Yeah. Adam Dahl was his name. Is his name.
And
but
the guy
like
driving?
Can't play anymore.
The guy
and
driving?
And we used to bust, we not bust a chop, but we used to say, dude, you have the coolest rock star name, Adam Dahl. Everyone's going to think you made it up.
And the guy who was driving bent down to get something? And
No, the guy, Adam Dahl, like, bent over, like,
you know, between...
Oh, and he got rear-ended.
And just happened
at that, time,
at that moment,
oh.
they just happened to get rear-ended.
Oh.
Yeah, it's fucked up. Why do you want to go here?
I know.
Didn't want to end on
yeah. It's like, so anyway, but so
shiny
we,
happy
so
people.
We played with a lot. we played with a lot of those guys coming up, and we were like 10 years older than Chris. Mm-hmm. Like it was funny. It was one of those bands. Like Keith was 2 or 3 years older than me. Joe was a year older than me. It was like, wait, when was the soft? One was a senior, one was a junior, and I was a freshman. So that's the way it would have broke out. And
Chris Penny was a baby.
Chris Penny was 16. And Keith worked for Chris's dad. And they had remained very close friends. And like he was one of those dads who was actually sort of more of a mentor.
He was a cool dad.
Yeah, very cool guy. And
supportive.
They bumped into each other, and he's like, you know, I got my son who's 16, and you know, he's learning to play drums. Literally learning to play drums, which is ridiculous to me because, like, again, 23, former drummer, 16-year-old, I originally was not into it.
Yeah.
All I saw were hassles. Mm-hmm. And then we went and jammed with him.
And he's like,
totally changed my mind.
Yeah.
And it was like, awesome. We'll work out all the hassles.
He's kidding.
His dad.
He is amazing.
Would come with us to the shows because we played in bars. Huh. And we wouldn't be able to play because he was 16 years old. And
isn't
most places
cool,
picked
though?
Up on it pretty quick because he kind of had a baby face.
Isn't that cool, though, that your dad did that? I guess
it's
all,
amazing.
I like to think that all parents would, but I don't know. Maybe they wouldn't.
I knew Chris Penny was a genius. We were playing a gig at the Tavern Off the Green in Morristown.
Oh, my God.
Okay, and I know this place, yes. It's still there.
It's across the street from the train station.
And Chris brought a trap kit, a hi-hat, a snare, and a bass drum. And his stool. About like 3 or 4 songs in, it dawned on me. I hadn't really noticed the difference. You know what I mean? He managed to make those 3 pieces sound like a drum set.
Damn.
That's the signature of
an amazing drummer.
I
knew he was a genius then. And so all his success never really surprised me.
Yeah.
And he left our band when he went off to go fucking Boston, that college... The music college in Boston, Berkeley.
Yes, right.
Yeah, so that's when
that little place.
Yeah, that little Berkeley School of Music. And then so Coheed again. There was a period where they lost half their band. Mm-hmm. He was playing for Dillinger, but Chris was always a guy who would go jam with other bands. He didn't think anything of it, like so because he played with us. He played with those guys.
Mm-hmm.
He was just a player. He wanted to play.
Right.
And so he started playing with Coheed. Huh. Like, as they're rebuilding. Now, their bass player cleaned up and came back. And so...
How does that work out?
And
the four
of them started writing the album that would have been their 4th album, I believe. The one after... You know, that was like the huge... Then they had an album after that, which was just as huge. Now, here's the thing. Dillinger got wind and got pissed. And threatened him with legal. Like, you're under contract. And he was. Wow. He was under contract.
Right. Those contracts.
With Dillinger and their record label and blah, blah. And it was a line in there, I'm sure, that said that he couldn't do any of that shit without permission or whatever. So it became a legal rigmarole. Fucking Coheed brought in Foo Fighters drummer.
Yeah, Taylor Hawkins.
Taylor Hawkins to play Chris's parts.
He is amazing.
Oh my God.
On the record. And I even asked him, I said, Chris, come on, love me. Are you on any of this? He's like, no way. They're not going to fucking legally jeopardize their standing with, you know, to not put me, you know, to say, to just put someone else's name on a record. It really is Taylor Hawkins, is the long story. Wow. But he got to hang out with him. He got to do all
cool.
That's awesome.
And so
yeah.
for like a period of a few years, he was the main drummer for Coheed.
Huh.
Then their bass player totally flaked out again.
Oh,
got busted for
trying to rip off
a pharmacy or some shit.
Ugh.
I remember
that was
he held it up or something, but he didn't have a gun. It was like the fucking gang that can't shoot straight because he was a drug addict.
Yeah.
Trying to
right.
So desperate.
Which we can't really bust on because fucking half the nation now is addicted to Oxycontin and everything else. So there you go.
Well, like Chris Cornell, right?
Poor Chris Cornell.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that what did it, though?
Well, they know the toxicology report, right? Just came out. It was a bunch of stuff.
So he was mixing. He was mixing. I'm sure he didn't kill himself on purpose. That's for fucking sure. Mm. I guarantee it. Unless he left a note, that was an accident.
Yeah.
And there was so much, oh, he killed himself, he hung himself and all this shit. And like I was like, what? His own wife said that she doesn't even think he was killed. They had a vacation planned next week.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Or some shit.
Yeah.
That was very sad.
Very.
It's easy especially for people to go to that, though, now, like these days.
Yeah, because you get prescribed it for fucking, hurt my leg.
Oh, yep.
I know.
Oh, my pimple burst wrong.
I know. But people don't know. They don't know, and they shoot out
that
all these.
That shit's addictive as fuck,
you know,
too.
Alternate facts.
And so fast, it doesn't even work.
But,
as someone who had elbow surgery, that shit didn't work at all.
What?
Oxycontin and all that crap.
Oxycontin doesn't work?
Maybe
for different people.
Maybe it's thought.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, and a lot of people like it worked for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Now I need another.
Yeah.
That was painful.
Hence the addiction.
Yeah, and well, this, we're talking nerve pain. But anyone who's had knee surgery is going to go through the same thing. I mean, like,
oh my God, nerve pain.
That
is so
stuff,
horrible.
And I don't know. It just works your brain in such a way that I mean, anything that literally makes you forget to breathe.
Yeah, it's a bad thing.
Right.
I mean, that's literally what it's doing. That's how these people die.
Yeah.
They're literally forgetting to breathe. It puts a part. There's a part of your brain that just does that. That's all it does. Mm-hmm. Remember to breathe, idiot. Mm-hmm. Remember to breathe, idiot.
Yeah.
The reflexive.
It accidentally puts it to sleep.
Yeah.
So if you take opiates, that's what you're doing?
Well, particular opiates. I think you would get that with heroin, but you'd have to take a big overdose. These fucking...
Yeah, you're on the right track there. P-H-E-N.
Yeah, that shit and the fucking Oxycontin itself...
No, it's F. I'm sorry.
...have the ability to do that.
It's the right consonant sound.
Yeah. That's fish, though, you're thinking of.
Yeah. They have the ability to do that as well, and they do it much better than heroin, as in tell your brain not to, to forget to breathe.
Really?
Mm.
Yeah. Particularly the fentanyl. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Fentanyl.
No, that's the diet shit.
That's what you were thinking.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Fentanyl.
It's in that fucking. Yeah, it is in that family.
Yeah.
Is that the shit that fucking Michael Jackson used?
No, that was. Oh, God.
Another kind of shit.
They were like giving him.
Sodium pentothal.
No.
They were giving him like anesthesia.
Yeah, like continuously. Like,
propofol.
Oh.
Am I right?
That's some heavy street drug.
I'm thinking like
propofol is a hell
of
a drug.
And I read that propofol
is
a couple of Flintstones chewables.
Propofol is what they give you now for oh my God, I'm having senior day today.
Migraine.
It's the microphone. It is the microphone.
No,
it is literally as soon as the microphone is in front of your face.
When they invade your buttocks to look for cancer, it is called
a colonoscopy.
Thank you very
fun.
Much. It is propofol. That's very good.
Thank you
the
very
new
much.
Ride at Disney. Wait.
Thank you very much. The colon cleanser. It's called a colonic. Thank you very much.
Correct.
Yeah, colonoscopy.
I've read that is the drug that they give you. Rotor. Yeah.
Oh, that's the thing that makes you glow.
Propofol?
Yeah.
What?
Well, isn't don't
during
we get that
during
about pledge? What are you talking about?
Isn't there shit that it, like you know it's like they give you a radioactive dye so they can see the shit inside
you?
That's
not what he's talking about, though. He's talking about like a pain sort of medicine.
No, and to put you under, right? I've read that they use propofol for colonoscopies.
You're thinking of the contrast.
Probably right.
You're thinking of the contrast that they put in.
That's for the heart, isn't it? When they do the radioactive dye, they did it to my dad.
It's not only for that, like MRI, I think.
A nuclear. They call it, yes.
Yes.
What do they call it? Nuclear.
a nuclear.
And this is safe?
Yeah, I know. Anything with the word nuclear.
Here, ingest this radioactive substance.
That's it, exactly. Yes. Nuclear
stress test. Yeah. It's a stress test when they tell you got to swallow something radioactive.
How could that be safe?
Radioactive.
And
then you turn into
that
an
was X-Men. My first concert, The Firm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Was it over here and fucking at the
Brendan Byrne Arena?
Oh my God.
I might have been there.
That was my first concert.
And then the Hooters were there too.
I don't think
that
was the same.
And was Rush there?
It was the outfield too.
Rush might have been there too.
Oh my God!
For the Grace Under Pressure,
yes.
Or were they fucking?
What? No, was it Presto at that time?
It might have been.
Mm. Yeah, I saw that tour.
Presto. Yeah, same year.
Sure that was tell. When they were getting into that like Earth fart. Like new soft jazz Rush.
That was my least favorite of the jazz of the Rush period. I think. Anyway.
Yeah, but that was like when they were, you know, what was that? Like with the chick from that
Amy Mann.
Yeah.
How do I remember Amy Mann? I don't remember colonoscopy.
I know.
You tell me.
Disassociate the two, then you're okay.
Everybody discuss.
You're afraid.
Till Tuesday. Yeah.
You're very afraid.
Just from Till Tuesday, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Correct. Taking the voices pipe. Carry.
Yeah, what was that? Time Stand Still?
Yes.
And then, of course, when Rush decided to get into the world of rap.
They did?
Roll the Bones. Yeah, right.
Why are we here? Because we're here.
Yeah, why are we here?
Why are we here for Chicks and Beer? Roll the Bones.
I also have, while I like the album.
Shout out to the Red Sector.
Yeah, right.
While I like the album, The Works, I always have a problem when people write songs that are a little too on the nose about an issue. And there's like a gay rights kind of song on there.
What is it called?
Gay rights.
I can't remember.
It's really, it was on the nose. No.
It's on
Rainbow.
You know, when I
that was Dio.
When my friend died today, that kind of shit.
It's like such
a dirge, and it's like
forced.
And Neil Peart wrote the lyrics to that.
I would assume so.
Because
from what I've heard, he writes.
I mean, he writes everything, but I'd say normally his lyrics are actually, I think, pretty poetic. No,
well, they're nice, but okay.
Like the past, I think, is a great song. Lyrically, I'm saying.
It's a little too schmaltzy.
Which one? The Pass? Or no, this song.
The song about the gay rights.
Oh, right, yeah.
If we looked at the album The Works, we could probably pull up the title in a second. But, yeah, and it's a little too...
On the nose, you were saying. I mean,
yeah, and by that, I mean, it's a little too much... Like, when I was first getting sober, God, the sobriety songs. Oh, my God, they were awful. But at the time, it's just a shit you got to go through. It's like, oh, it's my life now. But, like... that's what this feels like.
Okay.
This feels like the four. I need to write a song about how I feel about my gay friend. You know what I mean?
What's the name of the album?
It feels every bit
the
of
works,
it.
Right?
The Works,
right?
The Works. Yeah. It was the one with where they actually started playing rock again. Stick it out.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
The boys.
That wasn't Counterparts. No.
Counterparts.
It was.
That was
oh,
yeah.
Okay.
I was thinking of the Works for something. That's fucking Queen.
Counterparts.
The Works.
Yes, yeah, it is.
Yes.
Queen.
It wasn't coming up. Counterparts?
Counterparts is the name.
Okay.
So now you probably know the name of the song I'm thinking of.
No. And I can't remember the title. Yeah.
If I put it on YouTube.
Out there, bring out your Rush catalog.
YouTube will pull the we'll pull the show.
Okay, so there's Animate. Oh, Animate Me.
Yes.
That song.
But that's not it.
Stick It Out.
That would be a whole
album.
Different gay song.
Stick It Out.
Penetrate Me.
Yes. I was going to say, both of those songs would be very different.
Great song. Yeah.
Stick It Out sounds like a one.
Yeah, that would be too. The they one. All are, aren't they? Boy, when you add
maybe the whole album, what? No. When you take in.
What were the colors on that album cover? Is it the rainbow flag?
He's nobody's hero.
Oh, I know that.
Oh, God.
I never knew that was a gay rights song.
Oh, it says it right in the front. He's like, my gay friend died today.
Oh, wow. Okay.
He's nobody's hero.
Oh, my God.
Way too schmaltzy.
I guess I didn't listen close to the lyrics.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, I would just pick the songs that I would listen to more often and... Yeah, I think I probably
exactly.
Skipped.
To me, that's like Geddy Lee's sobriety song. It's like there's an area he probably shouldn't be in, or sorry, Neil. But I'm sure he had the best of intentions.
Sure.
But it just feels cliche.
Yeah, but
you know, on the nose. I don't know. It just feels kind of forced as a result. What are you doing?
Nothing.
What are you doing over there?
No,
you pulling up Alexa now?
I was gonna play.
She's
it.
Playing Candy Crush,
calling it audible.
They know. They've heard my dulcet tones. Hold it to your mic a little bit.
I am.
Boom!
There you go.
Gotcha.
You never noticed he was gay in the song?
Oops!
It's in the first fucking line, dude. and see that line in and of itself. It's so stupid. In a song? It just feels weird and forced. I'm going to write a pro-gay song. And not that as someone who's bi, I don't mind someone being supportive, but it just feels so schmaltzy.
Aw, he felt a shadow across his heart.
Okay.
I know this song, yeah. But obviously,
I thought nobody's here was about a deli.
I thought they were singing it in. Yeah, right? Yes, the Jared Subway song.
Feel my bony fingers on your knee. They're bony now because of Subway.
I lost so much weight. I can't work.
Now I'm going to eat you, but not like you think. I'm Jared Kushner. Oh, wrong guy.
All Jareds are evil.
Close enough.
No.
Fogel.
Oh, my God. That John Oliver is, yeah.
Yeah, I deleted it accidentally.
Did you
before.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh no!
It's so
before
funny.
The show, I was trying to clean stuff up and doing stuff fast, yeah. And I'll have to reload it later.
Oh God!
I'm Jared
Kushner. It's Gilbert Gottfried. Yeah. Oh my God!
Yeah, yeah, that threw me.
I'm Jared Kushner.
After 988 seasons of Planet Music, the Cromulons have decided to declare Earth the final winner and bring our musical reality show to a conclusion. Goodbye.
Get swifty.
Show me what you got.
I love Rick and Morty, but of all the episodes, the genius to that. I mean, I heard Kevin and Andy. Did you hear them talking about the third season episode?
We're still in the
Shonies.
Yeah.
We never left the Shonies. And they love
abort,
that.
Abort! Abort! Yeah.
And that episode is totally off the hook. I agree.
Oh, yes.
That is like demented genius.
But tell me, Morty. That's a Sean Sauce. It's my one-armed man.
but I still love, show me what you've got. That's definitely my favorite episode. But it also tackles religion. It's such a great commentary.
Nick just turned me on to that show. Like, I watched the first episode for the first time, what was it, 2 months ago, maybe?
Yeah,
something like that.
Months ago.
And I was like, this is the most brilliant thing I've seen since, like, the original Ren and Stimpy's, I thought.
Yes.
Yeah, it really is. It's one of those, like... And
I can't believe I hadn't discovered it yet, you know? I knew of it.
It was a passion project from the creator, because he liked fucking Back to the Future, and it's literally based on...
Doc and
Marty.
Right.
And he had to change the name.
That's names. Really cute.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah.
And Mr. Poopy Butthole.
Here
reminds me of Mr. Hanky for some
reason. So we gotta keep an eye out for any zany,
all right,
wacky
I gotta
characters
go.
That pop
everyone.
Up.
Ooh-wee. Adios.
Whatever you want, Rick. We're here to help.
Thanks, Mr. Poopy Butthole. I always count on you.
Got it all.
I can always count on you.
That was, I think, from Total Recall.
That's a great episode,
yes.
Too, because it's like, bye, sweetie, I love you. Gene had to leave, everybody. See, look what we maxed out. I also like to point out, this is at least our third time wrapping up the show.
Yeah.
So, I know.
I think Gene officially working.
Don't let it
Someone
end.
Else has to go to work
I'm
here, too.
I'm telling you, don't let it end.
Nice sticks
I
reference.
Like what you got. Good job.
And then you get shit like this.
Summer!
Tinkles, it's past my bedtime.
Not in Never Past Bedtime Land. Here we go! Tinkles, friends with each other.
Oh, God.
I like this end part here, where he's like...
You know what I think this is actually a parody of, though? There was a show, like a kid's show, I think it's a foreign one, called Lazy Town.
Yeah.
Never heard of it.
And somebody mashed one of the songs from Lazy Town with Little John.
The little girl with the pink hair.
Yeah, the little girl with the pink hair.
My kids were age appropriate enough for that show.
Yeah, but look for that one with Little John.
Okay.
Yeah, the rapper. And I think that's what they did.
Wow.
It was like an homage to that, like... That mashup.
Yeah. Remember that, Gene? You remember that show?
I do remember that show.
Yeah. Can't tell you how many times I jerked off to that show.
Oh, boy. Hey,
And I'm being arrested now because that's probably like a 14-year-old girl.
It wasn't us. It was Jared. No.
Yes. Oh, but... Well, what's that show with the weird people that look... One looks like a dildo...
and there's like an Asian guy, and there's four of them.
Oh, is that that weird? Oh, what the hell is it? Like Kapow, something or other?
Something like that.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
I haven't watched that one, but my wife.
Very weird.
Yeah, my wife and I have actually like gotten into the one like Star versus the Forces of Evil.
Oh, I don't know.
Is this on Adult Swim?
No, that's actually on Disney XD.
What?
Yeah.
Wow.
And it's just like so trippy.
They're getting edgy now.
Yeah.
Hey, that's a good idea. Something. Turn us on to something. I need something new. What have you guys been into? Turn us on to something as we go.
Like shows?
Something that you're into right now that you just would like to turn someone on to.
If you do massive amounts of drugs, watch American Gods. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't. No.
I have not seen it.
It's a Neil Gaiman, right?
Yeah.
The show?
Okay. Yeah.
I don't know. It is the strangest thing. We're only up to like episode 3, my wife and I, but like we have this, I can't believe that she likes it because it's so outside her element in the sense that you watch this and it's like watching Pink Floyd, The Wall.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean? But there is a coherence to it because it's all these different gods that are interacting with humans here on Earth. And I'm sure that there's something that ties us all together, but I'm still trying to figure out what the hell it is. But like visually, it's really beautiful.
Is it done its run or is it?
No. It's still ongoing. Okay. So they're up to like episode 5 or 6 now.
Oh wow!
But
so it's really new.
You should watch it and just kind of absorb it. And I don't know. I mean, it's I've never seen anything like it. Let's put it that way on TV. It's very very interesting. Watch. So
yeah, I gotta check that one out.
And if you tune out, I'm sorry, but
right.
it's worth checking out. Yeah.
Especially Neil
Gaiman.
It's bizarre.
Neil Gaiman.
If you love the Sandman.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Oh.
I have purchased but have not yet listened to Neil Gaiman recently did Norse Mythology.
Really?
Yeah.
Ooh, that I got to check out.
I haven't listened to it yet. I bought it on an audiobook. Thank you, Audible. Audible. AudibleTrial.com. ThatMan on ThatMan. Hey, we got it in.
Yes,
AudibleTrial.com/
shirt and he's
ThatMan on ThatMan.
Damn right.
So yeah, you can get it there for sure, Z's. I know that. But yeah, that's where I downloaded it from. I haven't listened to it yet, but I am very curious because I think, from what I understand, it's sort of him retelling the Norse mythology.
Yes,
in like,
that's exactly
in language that you can understand. It's
correct.
Like,
gotcha. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So
I definitely have to check that
out. That's my pick.
You know what I would recommend anybody, especially since you guys are here?
Mm-hmm.
I will say, another audiobook. I've listened to it a few times through because I loved it. The Daily Show book.
Oh, the one written by Jon Stewart. No?
Well, it's about the Daily Show with Jon Stewart. It tells I did it on audio.
I know of this
and they
book,
actually
yeah.
have a full cast of readers, none of which are actually the people, but they break up voices so a female voice reads a female part. And
so like a behind the genesis of the show.
Everybody has contributed. They tell, warts and all. Found out so much about that transition. Like, that was
over to Trevor Noah, you mean?
Yeah, to Trevor Noah. That was known for at least a year before announced. Shit like that.
Wow.
Like, yeah, you there's a lot of interesting back. Huh. I also get a kick out every time reads for Elliot Kalin.
Oh, God.
Because he gets a couple lines in. I'm like, we know Elliot Kalin. Just kind of like when I saw him on the show, too. He played, what was that? It was one of the earlier episodes. They put Elliot Kalin in the new MST3K as one of the characters.
Three. What was it? Yeah. Time Travelers?
Yeah, he's that weird guy.
With the drink that...
So these MST3K shows are definitely worth checking out.
Yeah, definitely check out the new season MST3K. Yeah.
The first one, I think, is the roughest, personally.
I love it because also it's a movie I thought was a fever dream. I saw as a kid. I never knew what it was. But then it's like, oh, crap, Reptilicus, that was the movie.
How about some of the fucking spoiler cameos there?
Oh, God,
I've been very
impressed.
I'm like, holy shit, what's he doing in here?
Yep.
Of course, Neil deGrasse Tyson's in there. But you don't but you don't see him, I don't think. You never see him, right? It's just is he in there? I forget. He's in like the third or fourth episode. He's a nanobot or whatever.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember now. I think you can.
Isn't Tom Hanks in there? No. Isn't he the Last Samurai?
Yeah, I think he is.
Last Samurai, Tom? No. Actually, that was one of the best jokes ever uttered on. Oh, so what do you guys think about Bill Maher using the N-word? That's
and
a whole other show.
I was going to say, that's a different show.
Other show. A whole other show. I have my own.
I heard the joke. I didn't have a problem with it. I wouldn't have had a problem with it, even if they didn't bleep it. So
I gotcha.
It happened so early in the show, too. I think it was forgotten by most people by the end.
Until it was just...
Yeah, a controversy.
Yeah. Mm.
But, hey, it's no... At least he didn't cut the president's head off in mock...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Stupidity.
Yes.
Oops.
And here's my theory. They're working together on that one. I think Trump paid her to do that. But
really?
That's my personal theory.
Oh.
Huh.
To sympathize him.
Sympathize him?
Yeah, sympathize him, yes. By demonizing...
is there a thing?
By demonizing her, by making him a victim. By making him a victim of this horrible joke of hers.
And no one's
You know they worked on Celebrity Apprentice together.
That's right. That's
right. You are correct
that
on that.
That is true.
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Wow.
Conspiracy
and
theories
are here's another thing. You notice how fast that sort of disappeared? Like, it was in the media hot for less than half a day. It kind of is there, but it's not like, I could remember if 10 years ago that shit happened. That's what leads me to believe it's probably a hoax put together for the Trump camp, by the Trump camp.
Wow.
An attempt to take a news cycle and soften him. Dude, the guy fucking paid Russians to throw the election for him. You think he has a big problem hiring Kathy Griffin to do
it? Yeah, I was going
to
say, I don't think her... Griffin,
She's far easier than Putin.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Probably cheaper, too. We don't have to give away all our national secrets to them.
No.
Payment. God. But if you want to hear more of this sort of horrible talk, you should go over to Bone Crushing Juggernaut or on YouTube, where my son and I do a horrible political show that is essentially the main theme is to troll Trump. So.
Have you listened to Pod Save America or Pod Save the World?
I have not, but I know. Yeah, I know them. I know of existence. I just it's like with everything else now. It's like you got to make an appointment to binge something at this point.
Yeah,
it's like
it's
fucking
true.
Nuts.
Dude, you should
see so much fucking. It's sitting there. I want to watch fucking Cloud Atlas, but unfortunately, it's a 3-hour movie.
Yes,
a 3-hour movie makes all the difference.
Yeah,
hour and a half, I'll blow it out. You know what I mean? Well, 3-hour movie, you know you're going to have to watch that shit.
Well, you know what? If you want a good recommendation, something to easily digest, like on your work thing, actually, Presidents Are People Too with Elliot Kalin and Alexis Coe.
Yeah, I've heard
okay,
it.
Okay, cool.
That it's a very interesting show.
Very educational.
Is it a podcast or
is it? Yeah, it's a podcast. It's also on Audible.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to figure out how to crack that bad boy there. How do I get on Audible? I'm very happy we are on Laughable, which is a great app.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
I haven't checked that one out.
If you're into why I like it and why I recommend it, it's not if you're into comedians in particular and you like stand up, what it does is it gives you a search so you can put in the name and they will tell you all the podcasts that person is on, even if they're not theirs.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah. And what's cool is I'm on there. And
cool.
As like a somebody.
Yay!
So weird. So weird. So, yeah. And so is Gene.
Cool.
And it's weird too, because if you as you type up Gene's name, because of the way the search works, at one point, Gene is shared on the screen next to one of the Jenners.
Oh,
oh
Kylie?
No.
If she does a podcast or does some sort of thing, then I guess it's Kylie or it's one of the Jenners.
Who was the other Jenner?
We're sorry.
It was actually Jean was impressed. She's like, she's famous. I'm on the same screen as a famous person.
No kidding.
But that's a good app too. I recommend it.
I'll check it out.
Particularly because it's all about that search engine that makes that it's for people who are into comedy.
Right.
Sweet. But they also pick a podcaster of the day and shit like that. So maybe someday it'll be me. I highly doubt it.
I also feel like Netflix is pushing so much.
All of them are.
Like Netflix, Hulu, where I can't catch up anymore. It's like, Handmaid's Tale. And all of a sudden it's like all these comedy specials. And I'm like, God.
And here's
a second. Slow down.
The Flash.
Mm-hmm.
Supergirl.
Right? Yes.
Now here's what happens there. I even subscribe on Amazon. Like I've already paid for the season, so they just drop in. And at the beginning of the season, I'm damn good. Then a week happens and I slip and I'll be like, oh, okay, let me get caught up. Oh, wait, I got to go back and watch that one first. Mm-hmm. Now I'm into 2 hours. It's a 2 hour commitment.
Yep. You're so right. I know.
So then you postpone it more, and now
you're really
both these seasons that I paid for that are like 24 episode seasons. I'm gonna binge them. Yeah. I'm gonna binge them all when they're done. But that's a weekend.
Oh,
they're
I know.
Right
yeah.
there.
You better believe it.
We are. And Kevin was talking about this. Where was this? At the show, I think we were at. It was a genius moment, too, mm-hmm. because a kid came up and was like doing the old, I have a script. It's a it's a Batman script. All right. Yeah.
It's like, all right. How can I really not get this to someone?
Exactly.
It's like, I have a script to hand to you. And it's a Batman script. It's like, nah, it's
he
not
may have
work.
Been, you know, like many, he may have been a little lit. He may have been a little something mm-hmm. when this. And, you know, Kevin won't openly shit on anybody.
No.
But
yeah,
he'll
too nice.
He'll certainly try and gently push them towards reality if need be.
Correct.
And that's sort of what he was doing with this guy. But that's when he said, dude, you can't do, nobody can have the story that happened to me anymore. It's just the industry doesn't work this way anymore.
Mm. No.
Even if you have a really great film, nobody wants it anymore because they're looking for documentaries. I guess I'm ahead of my time on another curve.
There
right.
we go.
And series. And so if you have a movie, expand the concept and write a show because they're not going to touch it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
I believe that.
That's what shit is like. And that's an insider saying that shit. So.
And you know what? And speaking of that, I was thinking about with Kev. You know, he's been doing these, you know, of
more
course
and more TV.
Yeah, he, you know, of course he has Comic Book Men, but yeah, he's been doing more and more in TV. He's,
and that
the
counts
Goldbergs,
as TV.
The, you know,
Goldbergs.
Flash, Supergirl.
Well, Goldbergs is definitely related because of what's his name was on there. Is the writer. The guy from Scrambled Eggs.
Myra. Matt
Myra.
Yes,
Myra.
Thank
from
you.
From the Nerds, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's like my one blank again.
Yeah, he writes over there. Yeah. He pulled in Kevin.
Yeah, but... Again,
but even still, I mean, that's networking.
But
that's how the industry works.
I think Kev should go actually a little more that route nowadays.
Dude,
yeah, it's
I
like,
totally agree.
Yeah,
well, you know,
do a Netflix, you know, series, you know,
the studio that he does Fatman on Batman is now in his house. So, mm-hmm. like the recent episodes, that studio, which used to be at a studio space, is now mm-hmm. in his house. So, yeah, he's definitely. We're all getting it. You know, you got a video. It's cheaper, it's easier.
Yep.
You got it now. If you do it, you may
accessible.
As well. Yeah. You may exactly. You may as well. It's almost expected. So, and the cool thing about Podbean, I'll give a plug to them. I didn't realize if you do something and you check YouTube, mm-hmm. like they make you that podcast with your cover on top.
Oh, it's nice!
Wow,
fucking A, yeah. So even if I don't want to film, it makes. Putting a video version of the show out
easy.
As easy as clicking a hash box, you know.
Sweet.
Yeah, so shout out to Podbean there. And that's more recent, too.
Yeah.
First time I realized, wow, it did this without me. Like, I didn't even ask. Mm. Apparently, I had checked the box. And unfortunately, it was on an episode where I said, there will be no YouTube version of this. Murphy's
Oops.
Law shitting on me again every time. I want to thank you guys for being on. We got to get you out of here because
someone's
got to get work in a half hour.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank
you.
Oh, dude,
it's
I love
been
having
a real
you guys.
Great time.
It's fun.
Yes.
We're still talking, and
we never,
I'm trying
no.
to, at the same time, I'm trying to throw you out of here.
I
but doing it gently. No, I like
thanks, Kev. Guys. And you know what? We're just going to end the show here because we're to make it nice and complete, and so I don't have to edit later. So we appreciate you spending time with us. And if no one else has told you today, then both. Both doesn't work. All of us here say you're smart and good. And we will check you next time. Now, where's my outro, which I could never find because I am a loser. See you next time, guys.
Nice.
as eyes we worship at our shrine. Bursting flowers into bloom, there's no such thing as time. Powers from our mother earth will blow us to our knees. Twisting, turning minds are burning, join us if you please.
There he is. It's that man standing over Blood Alley Square protecting us all. Go get him, that man.